Welcome to the Farming Simulator League World Championship Finals Recap. We are taking a look at Group A, where Trelleborg, Grimme, Komatsu Forest and Team of Elite Guys faced each other. Trelleborg, being the number one seed, were the clear favorites over Team of Elite Guys. The Russian team only barely made it into the top 16 by beating the Honig Gang in the tiebreakers. However, Team OEG did not know that Trelleborg was the favorite, so they came out of the gate swinging and beat Trelleborg 2-0. Next up, we had Grimme facing Komatsu Forest. Komatsu Forest had a very strong early season, but was very far behind later on. Grimme, however, was very strong throughout the whole season, and so they were the clear favorites going into that match. The first match of the loser bracket was Trelleborg, the Titans being super angry and Komatsu Forest being a little bit scared, and you can tell they were. Trelleborg came out and they were eager to show everyone that they are the favorites and they are the best team in the league, and they demolished Komatsu Forest and made it to the loser finals. The winner finals was Grimme versus Team of Elite Guys. No one had expected that, but Grimme didn't care. Team of Elite Guys thought they can do it again, but they couldn't. Grimme just destroyed them and won the group. The final match of Group A was Trelleborg versus Team of Elite Guys again, and we had seen that one before. Everyone was expecting Trelleborg to be super aggressive this time, but they weren't, and Team of Elite Guys was actually able to take the first game and lead 1-0 before Trelleborg even woke up. However, they did wake up in style and they crushed them the next two games, making it in 2-1 and making it as the group second out of groups. Now for Group B, we had John Deere, The Burning Gamers by Stark, My Insanity and Class. An interesting one for sure, and the first match of this group was John Deere versus My Insanity. The Swiss esports powerhouse has been there all season, but they weren't really able to grasp the idea of Farming Simulator League, and so they were no match for John Deere, who crushed them and went to the winners finals. Next up, the wildcard teams from the Burning Gamers by Stark. They faced Class. The Burning Gamers had a very strong showing throughout the season, and they were ready to face Class, and they were prepared to beat them. It took them about an hour, and it was 2-0 for Burning Gamers, and Class was out to the loser's bracket. And this is exactly where My Insanity was waiting. The Swiss guys had something to prove, and they did it with Class. 2-0 after very, very short games, My Insanity was not taking any chances and made it to the loser finals. The winner finals, John Deere versus the Burning Gamers. Everyone was quite sure this is an easy one for John Deere. However, the Burning Gamers did not exactly agree and fought back. It was a well-fought game with three matches, but in the end, the Burning Gamers by Stark took the victory and the group lead, sending John Deere to the loser's bracket where My Insanity was waiting. We had seen that match before. We had seen John Deere crush My Insanity before, and to be quite frank with you guys out there, they did it again. It wasn't nice, it wasn't beautiful, it was a complete mess and destruction. John Deere just rolled over My Insanity and made it out of group second. Next up, Group C. Krone, JCT Czech Republic, Horsch and Amazon. Amazon could not make it to the tournament, so that meant a free win for Krone and a free seed at the winners finals. The second match, JCT Czech Republic versus Horsch. Horsch was strong around Gamescom but has never shown up again, and JCT, ever since that wildcard team joined the league, it was insane. These guys were one of the best, everyone expected them to win, it was just clear who would win this. And exactly that happened. JCT did not wait. They killed them 2-0, sending Horsch to the loser bracket where no one was waiting because Amazon was not there. The winners finals, Krone versus JCT Czech. One of the best matches of the entire group stage. Krone was ready. They had Blackjack back, they had their confidence back, they knew what to do. However, JCT is strong and they were ready to show it. It was an amazing battle over three well-fought games. But in the end, Krone took the victory and the group lead. We had seen it before, again, same as Group A, same as Group B. The loser's finals was the same as the very first match. It was Horsch versus JCT Czech. Everyone, again, expected JCD to be strong, but for some reason, Horsch all of a sudden found their way into the game. And they were able to take a game of JZD and then another one, winning that one, kicking JZD out of the tournament and making it to the final eight. Last but not least, Group D. We had the Landeier by Astragon, we had Landwirtschaft 3.0, VK and Lindner. The first match, Landeier by Astragon versus Landwirtschaft 3.0, and it was a very interesting match, with the Landeier being one of the favorites of the tournament and Landwirtschaft 3.0 being an underdog. We haven't seen that wildcard team ever since they finished second at FarmCon 2019. Of course, the Landeier were dominating, destroying Landwirtschaft 3.0 and making it to the finals without any hassle. Next up, our second Czech team, VK, was facing Lindner. Lindner is an interesting team. They started very slow into the season, but they got stronger and stronger with every tournament, so there were high hopes on the guys from Austria. However, the Czech team was just the better team that day, beating Lindner 2-1 and advancing to the winners' finals. Lindner, with their backs to the wall, was facing Landwirtschaft 3.0 for a shot at the group finals, and they won 2-0, sending Landwirtschaft 3.0 out of the tournament. And this is where the tragic story of the Landeier started. One of their players, Davalda, was not able to connect anymore, so the Landeier were not able to play with three players, losing the first game against VK with only two players playing that game to the end. Of course, the Landeier reacted to this situation and brought in Gammelbacke, their star player who could not make the beginning of the tournament but was ready now, substituting him for Davalda. Still, it wasn't enough to face VK that day. The Landeier were clearly shell-shocked, couldn't do anything, and without Davalda they weren't able to do anything, and VK won the second game, beating them 2-0 and sending them to the loser bracket. But the tragedy of the story did not end there. Lindner was waiting, and they were able to fight hard against the favorites of the Landeier. Again, Davalda was not in. Again, it was Gammelbacke, but this guy was out of the tournament for a couple of weeks and his practice was lacking, and it has shown. Lindner was able to win a game, and the Landeier were able to win a second game. So we had a final match, and everyone was concerned that the Landeier could not make it out of groups. And indeed, they couldn't. Lindner won that one, winning 2-1 and sending one of the big tournament favorites out. And that's it for the group, guys. That's what happened during the group stages. We have seen favorites fall. We have seen Trelleborg losing. We have seen the Landeier leaving the tournament. We have seen JZD Czech leaving the tournament. Everything is possible in the Farming Simulator League World Championships. And I want you to check out what's next and who is our first world champion.
Good morning, everyone. This, of course, is not me. This is Martin Rabel, our host, speaking German. So I'm gonna translate what he's saying for you guys so that you have an idea what's going on. Yeah, we had more than 100 teams participating in the online and offline tournaments of the Farming Simulator League. Only 16 made it to the group stage of the World Championship, and only 8 made it to this day and to the quarterfinals. They are competing for prizes of a total prize pool of more than 100,000 euros. And this trophy, of course, and the right to call yourself the Farming Simulator League World Champion.
Die mit euch zusammen an diesen Tagen die Spiele beobachten, kommentieren und analysieren werden.
Martin is introducing the casters now. He will introduce the German casting team. They are there, Ansgar, Niklas and Werner.
We also have an English stream, so just in case you didn't understand anything what I just said, you might be on the wrong channel. So there's also a Twitch channel, Giant Software, without the D at the end. So head over there and you can listen to our English casters, Alex and Lars. Und jetzt möchte ich ab.
And that's us! Hallo Alex!
Dir noch mal ganz genau erklären, wie denn so das Turnier an diesem Wochenende.
Hello!
Are you ready, my friend?
I am psyched. This is going to be an incredible final.
It will be.
And so the group stages were insane. Absolutely so many twists and turns, so many unexpected things, and now, yeah, looking at this final, this is going to be something special.
It will be, and we're gonna have only best of threes. We should mention that only best of threes today, four of them, and tomorrow we're gonna see the semifinals, which is best of three again, and the big grand finals, which is for the first time ever a best of five.
And yeah, best of five. I don't know how quite that's going to affect the teams.
Neither. I mean, no one has ever played the best of five, right?
No.
It will be interesting.
I know, that's the thing. It's going to be a whole different dynamic to see how teams come from. You know, if a team is leading that final 2-0, I'm intrigued to see how that is going to affect the other team and whether anybody can pull it back from that kind of thing, because that would be a one heck of a final to see that. But
it would be awesome. It would.
But
be
first,
awesome.
We've got today's stuff, which is going to be absolutely incredible.
It absolutely will be. By the way, guys, we are listening to the German guys now on our stream. This is not great. Let me fix that, Alex. Keep talking.
I don't know if that went through onto the English stream
was,
or not.
No, certainly for some reason we were all of a sudden getting the German.
I'm just going to say before going further, hello to everybody in the chat. We're slowly building numbers of viewers here, and I'm seeing lots of familiar faces in the chat today. So hello, apparently. Chris is telling me that I need to entertain people. I would sing and I would dance, but I'm not on camera, so the dancing would do nothing, and nobody wants to hear me sing.
Yeah,
so
we totally should focus on the World Championships here. As we said, eight teams are left. Out of 94 that started, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was 94. These are the eight best teams, and we're gonna have, as we said, quarterfinals today. Four matches, all of them best of three. We're going to start later on with Grim about Lindner and talk about this as soon as it starts. Then tomorrow, guys, I need to mention it. At the same time, noon German time, 11 a.m. British Standard Time, we will see the semifinals and the finals. And then after that, we will have a Farming Simulator Leap World Champion.
Which is just... This has been a hell of a journey to get to here. So many games, so many events. Trelleborg just sort of dominating most of it for the season,
and then choking in groups, and then choking in groups.
And John Deere the same. You know, the two top teams, just playing, winning again and again and again, and then just those group stages really showed that at this point in the competition, anything can happen. You know, it really can. And, yeah. And today is... We're going to see teams go out.
I have to interrupt you here, because I just got word that the teams for the first match are ready. So we have about like 10 seconds left before we're going to see Martin again and the first two teams. And then we get to head into the action and, watch the matches. So are you ready, Alex?
I'm ready.
Let's
this is going
to
be
give
great.
The stage over to Martin. And let him bring in the teams.
Ja, also die Teams stehen bereit, wir sind bereit, die Traktoren, Drescher und Pressen sind bereit. Dann möchte ich das erste Team begrüßen. Am blauen Tisch spielt heute Grimme mit Scotty, Martin und ihrem Captain Marcy. Ah, da kommen sie schon rein.
Team Blue, ihr seid
bereit.
Grimme.
Ja, sind wir, hat es geheißen. Also dann bin ich mal gespannt. Dann wollen wir mal schauen, ob Ihre Gegner auch bereit sind. Denn das rote Team wird vertreten durch Lindner, Floji, Dropwell und Cerceros.
And there is Team Red, Team Lindner, the Austrian team that made it to the finals, surprisingly.
Ich mag die Outfits,
and
muss ich sagen.
Here we are.
Aber ich wünsche natürlich beiden Teams viel Erfolg.
Style. Auf der Lederhose. Alex doesn't know what to say. It's like, are these Lederhosen?
I'm speechless. That's just...
Well, we shouldn't forget that Oktoberfest was supposed to start today, right? This is the start of the Oktoberfest season. For obvious reasons, that's not going to happen. We're going to see the statistics. Grimme finished 6th in the regular season. Lindner finished 8th. Grimme has an average bales delivered of 30 to 29 by Grimme. Average grain delivered, however, Grimme only 32,000 and more than 36,000 for Lindner, which is, by the way, league record. So that is super interesting. Average points, we can see that here. However, Grimme being the tournament favorites now, more than 50 points on average more than Lindner. They only played against each other twice. You can see that down there, the head-to-head score. Grimme won it once and Lindner won it once. And we shouldn't forget, do you remember, Alex? That was one of the most interesting games we've seen so far. That was this DreamHack Leipzig. It was the only draw.
It was, yeah. And it's that, I mean, to get, and then it was an exact points draw. So we, just to do that is really difficult, especially it's one of those things which I don't think we'll see again, simply because the teams have got so much better at doing at altering the grain bonus now.
Yeah, a lot of things have changed since then, and we shouldn't forget one thing here, that Grimme has a new team since then. I mean,
they do. That's true.
Yeah, they switched out Donnerkeil for Martin, and while that back in the days, it was Martin was a substitute, he is now one of the top players, if not the top players within Grimme, and he's no longer a substitute. This team is now in the best setup they can have, and they've shown it during group stage. It was a complete disaster for everyone else. Grimme was just super strong. So these three guys are ready to rock. However, Lindner, they have surprised, and I wonder if they're going to do it again.
It's one of those things where anything can happen, and at this point, I would say nothing would surprise me, but there's lots of stuff seeing the matchups and things today that I'm thinking very much that this is going to be a close game. I mean, these two teams, as you saw from the stats a minute ago, they are very close in the number of bales they deliver. But Lindner has a bit of an advantage in its overall stats in that they tend to deliver more grain. So if they can take advantage of that, they can take advantage of their ability to deliver that extra grain, then they can take this.
Yeah, they absolutely can.
It's about timing, and it's all about getting things in the right place at the right time.
I can't wait to see what's going to happen. Not gonna lie.
Yeah.
This will be super interesting.
It's the anticipation at the moment. It's where is this gonna go? How is it, how are the teams gonna play? And it's
And teams are getting ready.
And this is the other thing is this is the first time the teams have met face to face like this since we were in Poland.
Yeah. I mean, that was the last offline tournament we had anyway.
Yeah,
because of everything that was going on afterwards, there were no more offline tournaments. By the way, Alex, how do you like our new studio?
I do. I love the new studio. I am very much looking forward to getting out there and seeing it in person at some point. For those who don't know, I am still stuck here in the UK, while everybody else is nicely in the new studio. It looks gorgeous.
It absolutely is. It is a fantastic new studio, and we are super happy that we were able to host the World Championships here. Of course, we had to go down to 8 teams. That's why we did it in an online tournament. But here we are now. The teams are here. The teams are ready, more or less. And the German casters look happy as well. Mm-hmm. We are trying out a new system where the stream has a expert. You can see Niklas on the right side. He is a former Komatsu player. And Alex is stuck with me, so there's that.
Yeah.
It should be fine. We will head over to the first game in about 20 seconds from now. So, any final words? What do you think is going to happen? Is it a 2-0? Is it 2-1? Alex, your prediction?
I think this is going to go to three games. I think it's going to be a 2-1. I cannot call which team it's going to go for. I think these two teams are very evenly matched.
Well, that camera and, was tricky.
And yeah, it's very difficult.
Let's head over. River vs. Flinder.
Game one.
And this means the Farming Simulator World Championship has officially started.
River is going first, and their first ban is... JCB doesn't go out here, I'll be amazed.
Yeah,
but
it will be.
The Styre, of course. First. And there goes the JCB. As we would expect.
I expect the Deutz. Yeah, there is the Deutz. Yeah, I expected the Deutz to go. Maybe the Fendt will go as well. Maybe the Telehandler will go. No, it's the Fendt.
Interesting is that, yeah, you're right. The Master Focus and Telehandler is still in play, though. And it'll be interesting to see if either of these teams go for it.
I don't think so. Neither of these teams have utilized it, so I was wrong.
That took all of 3 seconds, I think.
Well, we shouldn't forget it is super fast, right?
It is super fast, and it does give you an advantage. When your belt is slowed down and you've delivered a lot of grain, that is a great thing to have.
Absolutely. And there's the New Holland as well. This is awesome. We have seen that one all the time. New Holland is one of the most picked stackers. Same for the Valtra that has been picked by Lindner. And I expect narrow tires to come in now, and there they are for both teams. Pretty similar setup. A little bit on the faster side for Grimmer.
So, I expect whoever's in that telehandler, I'm fully expecting them to go and grab a combine because
absolutely
can't tow a baler.
So. No, it can't tow a baler, and it is very very fast. We shouldn't forget that. Mind. I think, yeah, it has to be... Yeah, it is the fastest, so it's 63 km/h. I don't know what that is in miles per hour, sorry. But it is very, very fast.
40-ish miles an hour, I think, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I guess so. So, I expect Grimmer to go down and grab as much as they can. I think part of their strategy now is to take everything away from Lindner. Because they picked these fast vehicles. Let's see what they do.
That is a fast setup Grimmer have gone for. That is a fast set of tractors.
Yeah, and you can see that they're going down for the harvesters right away. They try to grab the John Deere and the Ideal. It's the same for Lindner, but they are just not as fast. That's just what happens.
Grimmer have got the Krone Baler. That is going to be a huge advantage to them straight off.
Yeah, they also have the Ideal, and they will grab the New Holland.
Who has the John Deere? Does anybody have the John Deere Combine? Yes, is that? I think Grimmer have grabbed the John Deere Combine. By the look of thing. Ooh, that's a combine streak. That's a harvester streak.
This
for Grimmer.
Is disastrous for Lindner.
That is not good.
Did they even get anything? Or is that already a rush? No, they got the.
They did get the case harvester, but that is.
Big disadvantage. Yeah, big disadvantage.
That is less straw. Less grain, everything has gone Grimmer's way at this point. And it'll be interesting to see how Lindner adjust for this now. Because it's not even... It's a very sort of average combine that they've got. It's not the fastest. It's not the one that holds the most grain or anything like that. And it's as a result, they are in a little bit of shtuck.
So Lindner has to fight an uphill battle here. We will see how they manage to do that later in the game. For now, big advantage to Grimmer. You can see that they're already on their way, pressing bales, making sure everything is set up nicely. Nope. They will not utilize the New Holland combine. They just picked it so that Lindner
One thing that Lindner have going for them is they have the Fendt baler. And I think if I was looking at the situation they're in, the way I would go is I would leave that. I would get a tractor with the baler running behind the combine all the time. Have the third player then just coming and picking bales off the field and getting them back all the time. And that way, when you get to the point where you can score points, then you're able to. And he's got himself stuck on the bridge.
And this bridge is going up now, but...
Oh no! This is Lindner having an absolute nightmare.
Oh, no, he made it. He's fine. All planned.
But they do seem to be doing that. So they do have a player now who is just bringing back bales all the time. And I would guess he's going to go for that first bale points.
Yeah, they have to.
Lindner needs to be doing things like that. Every little advantage they can get now, they need to take.
Yeah, and then they definitely need to make sure that they get the bale boost, because if the grain boost is picked later on, it's pretty much game over for them. They can't compete with the amount of grain Grimma is getting now, because they only have one harvester. So this is just not working for them.
Amazing unloading here from Grimma. Beautifully stacked with that chrome baler. And Alinda again, taking advantage of stuff. Letting their straw build up on the field a little bit so that they can then have something to continually bale. But also making sure that combine is continually moving. That is the only way Lindner are going to have a chance in this, is if all of their stuff is continuing to flow and they don't stop on any of their stuff going at any point.
Exactly. And if you think about how the teams usually approach everything of this later on, for now we see Grimma using two combines, but that will change, right? Around the maybe 9-minute mark, they're going to switch to only one combine harvester and have only one player using one of them while the other one is unloading. And at this point, it's not too bad anymore when it comes to grain, because both teams only have one harvester on the field.
I also missed that Lindner picked up the transport company.
Yeah, I missed that as well, but they did. So the Anderson's on the field.
And actually, for the situation they're in, that's not bad.
No, it was actually a good pick. I mean, that's probably not planned to only have one harvester. It would confuse me a lot if they planned to do that. But just because things played out as they are, it's good for them. They don't need the Krone Press, so it's okay to not have it. Of course, it's always sad if the other team has it, but it is okay to not have it. All they need to do now is to make sure the Anderson is probably filled. And they do have Cerceros. You can see him here in the front, the team captain. He's one of the best stackers in the league. So with the Anderson, he should be able to get a lot of bales onto that conveyor belt very quickly. All he needs is that specific boost. He can't have the grain boost happening, or they will have a lot of issues.
It's intriguing to see that Lindner are actually making the best. It's one of the best reactions I've seen to a single harvester.
Yeah.
And it seems like they have been very prepared for this situation. That's an interesting...
What happened
to the bale on the back of that?
Oh, you can see the ideal is full. This is...
Oh, wow.
And he has the biggest grain tank in the game, so...
Yeah. There is a lot of grain for Grimma at the moment, which... Oh! That was almost very nasty.
But nothing happened. All good. All planned.
So a lot of field harvested for Grimma now. They are definitely ahead in the grain. And as you said, the bale boost... is something Lindner needs in order to maximize what they can.
Absolutely. For the newer players, what that means is there is a drone drop. There's a drone flying on the field somewhere, and somewhere between minutes 8 and 6, so in about 40 seconds from now, this drone can drop two different boosts, one of which gives you more points per bale delivered into your barn, and the other one makes sure that the grain you are harvesting, if you deliver that one into your silo, you get more out of that. Because there are three harvesters on the side of Grimma, and Grimma can utilize two at a time, while the third one is just standing somewhere, not doing anything, they will have way more grain. So the boost that increases the amount of points you get because of the grain is a nightmare for Lindner right now. However, Lindner, the bale boost could work.
Lindner needs to... get that Vultra they've got off the baler right now and empty their combine. While this is unloading and while the baler's almost up behind the combine, makes sense for them to go and empty the combine, get the grain out of it, keep that combine moving. And then because they've got that fast Fendt baler, they can then come up behind and collect up the grass. And it is the bale boost.
Lindner got what they needed, and the Anderson is ready. It's standing there. And look at that. Grimmer is not as prepared. There are not that many bales ready. However, Lindner has Satsurus here, and Satsurus will now unload bales, and it's 30 points per bale that you get in there. And because of the Anderson, they will get a lot of points in a very short amount of time.
This is an impressive response.
Absolutely. It is the perfect response. It is the perfect response to what happened in the beginning. You are at a big disadvantage because of the rush, and now you have to make sure you get the points. And look at that. Grimmer is not scoring points.
Grimmer are not prepared for this at all. And Lindner are just scoring points.
Lots of points. There is a minute left on that boost. You can see it on the lower left corner. There is this nice bluish, greenish, I don't know what the name of that color is in English, to be fair. Power-up highlighted that says it's a minute left. And it's 252-0. Grimmer is just starting to get points now, and Lindner is way ahead.
300, and it looks like Grimmer are panicking a little bit.
Yeah, you can see Scotty not being happy.
They're not picking up bales properly. They're putting single bales on. They're just not going to come out of this bale boost as well as Lindner are. Now, I think what they might be working with is the fact that they have so much more grain, so they're looking to try and
absolutely. I mean, that was like 32,000 liters. So they are heading over now.
There are still over 300 points between these teams.
Yeah, but Lindner's running out of bales, and they are not ready to get the multiplier back. So what grain does here is, if you deliver grain to the silo, you see on the top of your screen the 0.3.0, 0.2.0. Now it's down to 2.3, going up. It is like a scale. The more grain you deliver, the more points per bale you will get when you use the conveyor belt, and the less points per bale the opposing team will get. So now that the boost is over, Grimmer is unloading, making sure that they get 30 points per bale when delivering, and you can see it here, 29 points that would be, times 2.9. And only times 1.1 for Lindner. So that means that they will only get 11 points per bale instead of the 29 by Grimmer. And this will turn around the game. So Lindner has to react.
You can see here the difference in the amount of grain that Lindner has.
Yeah.
They will be able to pull it back a bit.
Not much, though.
These points are now going to close. Have Lindner scored enough during that bale boost?
They know. There are almost 5 minutes left. There are almost 5 minutes, and if you think about it, for Grimmer, at the moment, it's a permanent bale boost. Because the bale boost will grant you 30 points, right? And now they get 29. And look at this, they are just waiting for Lindner to try to change that. And as soon as they start trying to change that, they will unload again, because they still have grain left. They are just waiting for Lindner. So now is the time for Grimmer to turn around the game, to make the most out of their grain. And you can see it here, it's only 200 points left is the difference between them, and there are a lot of bales going in for Grimmer. However, Lindner can't even deliver bales. It won't give any points.
Here we see Grimmer beginning to try and claw some of that advantage back that Grimmer have, but it's not going to be enough grain.
It's not much. And there are only 100 points left. That's only like 5 bales. Lindner definitely needs to deliver a lot of bales. You can see Grimmer is closing the gap. They are almost there.
A 6-point advantage per bale.
Yes, that's a lot. And Grimmer is ready to deliver more bales. However, we don't know where the Anderson is, right? Because we shouldn't forget that Lindner is not scoring a lot of points just randomly over the course of the game. They are scoring a lot of points as soon as the full Anderson is back. So we need to see where the Anderson is. There will be a time where Lindner is scoring a lot of points again. However, only 17 points per bale. That means there's not much coming in. And Grimmer is only 2 points behind now. So, yeah. I'm back.
3 minutes left on the clock, and Grimmer have gone into the lead by 44 points here. So Lindner do need to start delivering some more bales back. With less than 3 minutes on the clock, it's a bit difficult now. They need to get those bales back.
They absolutely do. And the problem here is that Grimmer will not stop delivering bales. They are pressing bales all the time. You can see here that Scotty is just picking up his own bales. He's not waiting for his guys to deliver. And as long as they have bales, as long as they deliver bales, there's no way for Lindner to come back. Right? What Lindner needs to do is they need to deliver more bales now. So they need to hope that Grimmer can't deliver that many. However, there is nothing coming in for Lindner right now. Where is the Anderson?
It's sitting empty in the middle of the field.
And that's just disastrous. This is a game for Grimmer.
What are they doing? They should not be trying to deliver more grain.
No, it is the wrong way to do right now. They need to focus everyone on making sure that they get more bales on, because they are in a grain disadvantage and they won't change.
Following that early loss of the second combine, this is the first real mistake I've seen them make on this. They've got a minute and a half. Okay, they've evened it up quite a bit, but they are over 100 points behind now. And they're just not delivering bales.
No, and I don't know why they are not utilizing the Anderson again. This doesn't make any sense to me. I mean, yes, the Anderson is slow, but they had enough time. Instead of delivering all the bales and just pushing them down right and left to the conveyor belt, they should...
We got an aerial, and the bales have gone flying.
Yeah, well, that can happen if you just jump like this. But yeah, 1 minute left and 100 points. Ah, that can't happen.
Oh, no, that's...
That bale is lost, by the way. Bye.
That is not good. Lindner did not need that. But they are closing the gap.
They are closing the gap, but it's not enough. It is not enough. They need way more bales. And Grimmer has more than enough bales to just continue stacking bales for the next 40 seconds. Yeah, and
only six bales here, that's not enough.
I don't get why teams do that. Why, if they are behind like that, if they don't have two harvesters, why are they trying to get the bonus back to even? They can't anyway. So focus on bales, create more bales, make sure you get as many bales as possible on that conveyor belt, and make sure you get the points in, even if you get little more than 15 points, like 16 or 17, it doesn't matter. You can't waste your time.
Not enough bales.
No, it's not enough. One and zero, Grimmer. And this is the first game taken over by Grimmer. 801 points. That is a good score.
That is a very strong score. Grimmer delivered four more bales than Lindner did. Just on the face of it. You know, it's so much. 3,000 more litres of grain as well. That is proper domination from Grimmer. Even though it didn't seem like it halfway through. I think it was just a big misstep to try and even up that bonus. They needed to get bales in, not even the grain up.
Yeah. And you can tell. I mean...
And, yeah.
It wasn't ideal.
It will be interesting to see how much that Lindner go make sure they get that second combine in the second game.
Yeah, that is the most important thing, is they need to get that second combine.
Their strategy would have worked really well had they had two combines, because it was that the whole thing of them not being able to create enough straw and then not being able to create enough grain. That is what really, really cost them in that game, and it's strategy that is a strong one, but it was just let down by a couple of choices.
Yeah, it was. But still, it was a good match. You can tell that Lindner is prepared. They are good. They are in a disadvantage, or they have been in a disadvantage from minute one. Given that they were in a disadvantage, they played very well.
And there's the Farming Simulator League trophy. One team will be holding that above their heads tomorrow. Or holding it. Don't know about above their heads. But they will be holding it tomorrow after being crowned the Farming Simulator League champions.
Yes. And these two teams are fighting for it. Grimma, the tournament favorite right now. We have, you know, there were a couple of tournament favorites, like John Deere, of course, JZD, Trelleborg, of course. They all choked during the group stage. Grimma didn't. They just didn't. They crushed everything in front of them, and now they are the clear tournament favorites for now. However, everyone can win this. Okay, the teams
which
are getting
is,
ready
is
for
an amazing
team, for
thing
two.
After this season. For Grimma to be the tournament favorites,
yeah,
is
very unexpected. They came in as a team that no one expected anything from back in FarmCon last year. They got stronger ever since, and ever since they added Martin to the team, I think it's Martin's his name, the young guy in the middle. They are just a powerhouse. Okay, game two is starting now. Here we go. Back to the wall. They need to win two in a row to stay in the tournament. Otherwise, their world championship run is over.
And this time it is Lintner picking first. So their first ban of choice is the...
I hope they... Yeah, I was about to say, yeah, I hope they go. Make sure the telehandler is not in there anymore.
That telehandler's not coming in again. No. I'm not surprised by that. The Deutz has been banned by Grimma.
They will most likely see the Steyr being banned. Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, and then we're expecting the JCB.
Yeah, or the Big Fend. It's the JCB.
It's quite interesting to see that telehandler left open last time and Grimma using it to full effect, getting that speed at the start to make sure they got those harvesters.
Yeah, that is lesson learned here. It's like, yeah, we are not going to do that again. that was hurtful. So,
there's the Big Fend.
Yes. It's a powerhouse. We shouldn't forget about that. The Big Fend, very, very strong. Lindner has the Vulture.
No choice of the T6 New Holland at the moment, which tends to be a good all-rounder. There it is. It has gone over to Grimma.
Yeah, but we see teams picking either. Sometimes they pick the New Holland, sometimes they pick the Valtra. Both work. We know Trelleborg, for example,
Massey,
first.
That Massey is actually quite a strong tractor.
Yeah, it absolutely is. Oh, no narrow tires this time for Team Grimma. That is interesting. And I wonder if Lindner is going for the Anderson again, or if they go with Slide Edge chip tuning to just get a little bit more speed, because they really can't be slow anymore. Slide Edge, there we are. And I expect chip tuning to be fair, but you don't know. You never know what they are going to do. No, it's Transport Company again. Lindner is going for Transport Company again.
They're looking to be disruptive, Lindner. They are looking to try and do something different to try and disrupt what the other team is doing.
So, they need a better start now. Everything comes down to they need a better start now. Let's see if they can manage to get a better start. The harvester setup is random at the beginning of every round, so it is not the exact same position. Grimma, of course, going down to the John Deere and the Ideal again. They are not wasting any time. Lindner is a little bit slower again. They are slower again. Let's hope that they manage to get... They have the case. So what happens to the New Holland? This is the only question right now. What happens to the New Holland?
New Holland is still available because... No, Grimma have got it!
Grimma got
the New Holland. It's a second harvester streak for Grimma. This is not good.
Disastrous. Absolute disastrous. The exact same thing that happened before. However, how many balers does Lindner have right now? Do they have more than two?
Good question.
If they get the two balers, that is a rush. Oh, no.
Lucky
for Grimma, they got one.
But why is the Crone Baler still open at this point?
I don't know. Why is no one picking it up? Why is no one picking the Crone Baler up? Well, fine then.
I'm amazed by that. I'm amazed that Grimma managed to get as their own. We didn't have a Baler streak, did we? No. But I am amazed that their second Baylor choice was the Crone.
Everyone is like, oh yeah, the other team is probably
the
grabbing
other team's
the Crone.
Going for that. Which yeah. I think it was because it was right out on the right hand side.
Probably.
But that is
That was I don't think I've ever seen that before. I don't remember a single match where I've seen the Krone being picked last. It's like, this is not happening. Usually it is not. And yeah, let's talk about the situation here. We are in the exact same situation we have been before. Grim has 3 harvesters. Lindner has only 1, which means that Lindner needs to do the exact same thing they did before, just better. And for Grimme, they just need to play it down, do the same thing they did before, and then they are in the semifinals. So Lindner really, really under pressure here, has to show something.
This is the disadvantage of going for transport company over going for slight edge and chip tuning.
Absolutely.
I think what you have to do, if you do go for transport company like this, you go for the 2 less interesting combines. So you go for the New Holland and you go for the Massey Ferguson, because the other team with a speed run like that, they are going to go for the 2 big harvesters.
Exactly. The Massey Ferguson being a case, by the way.
And it's... sorry, yes, the case.
why I'm the expert. All good.
Yeah, that's why you're the expert. I'm hyped now. this is why. And so the whole thing that they need to do is if you get those two harvesters, then you're still going to have 2 harvesters. If you go for one of the bigger harvesters or one of the harvesters that have the small advantage, then you're going to end up down with just a single harvester, if you get a harvester at all.
Yeah. And this is just a nightmare. You need to make sure you have 2 of these, because there are so many disadvantages in not having 3 2 harvesters at least. It is not too bad having only a bale press, as long as you have a good one.
If you're running this as well.
Yeah. But only 1
if
harvester.
If you're running the transport company, you only need a single baler, so you can survive a bale rush with it.
Absolutely do. So, yeah, what do you expect? I expect this game to go the same way the last one did. Not gonna lie. I don't think Lindner has what it takes to change the game now. So, yeah. I totally see Grimme making it to the semifinals now.
Yeah. If they get the bale bonus and they can keep their harvester moving all the time and they unload as they're going, then yes, I think they've got a chance. They're not going to have the same amount of bale of wheat, so they're not going to keep that bonus the same. But they've just got to come to terms with that and just deliver more bales.
Absolutely. And that's what they need to do. They need to change a couple of things. They need to make they need to do what they do now. They need to keep unloading. They need to keep harvesting. They need to make sure that they have more grain than they had last time. They can't have more than Grimme. That's almost impossible. But they can have more than they had. And then once they delivered, first of all, they need the bale boost, right? If the game is going for grain boost, that's disastrous. But yeah, if they get the bale boost and they do the exact same thing they did last time, they score like 450 points during that 2-minute window, they're in a good position. And then what they need to do is they need to unload once. And then whatever the outcome is of that, keep it like that. Start using all the balers you have. Press as much as you can and get as many bales as possible in. Don't waste one of your guys trying to get that 0.1 or 0.2 back, unless you know that you can't have enough bales, of course. If you know that you can't have enough bales, you need to do that. But, I mean, we have seen it. We have seen that they delivered less bales than Grimme did. And this can't happen now, because if you can't win by the bonus, so you have to win by bales.
Yeah. And you just have to push it and keep going, keep that combine going, keep that baler going. If either of those 2 stop, then you're sunk.
Yeah, then you're pretty much out of the tournament. And Lindner is pretty much having a miracle run right now. No one expected these guys to even be here, because they were in a group that was a nightmare with Nylandeyer in there. But they managed to do it. They managed to come back. They managed to fight back. And I think there's a lot of hope that they can do it again. So let's find out and let's see. Again, one of the advantages we have here is that Grimme does not have any narrow tires, So that means they have to either drive slow or go all the way around or make sure that they carve the way out. So there are a couple of things that Grimmen needs to do now with the setup they have, but these guys know. They practice a lot, like 5 to 6 times a week right now. They know exactly what they are doing.
And the window for the bonus is about to open.
Yeah, it's opening now. We have a 2-minute window.
It would actually play very much into Lintner's hand for a late boost.
Yes.
If it happened around the 6-minute mark, that then gives a minute for them to use the boost and limits the amount of time that Grimmer would have an advantage in the bonus in their multiplier. So
absolutely,
a six minute mark. Yeah, I think when this drops, when these power up drops, that is going to also shape the end of this.
Yeah. What was Lindner even doing? I didn't realize that the second bay pressed Grimmer God was defend. So they have the fastest and the biggest. And three harvesters.
How they manage that?
They got pretty much everything. You know, this is a dream setup for Grimmer. They have three harvesters. The ideal is amongst them. At the moment, it is the strongest harvester. They have two bay oppressors, but they got the two strong ones.
And look at all that straw that Grimmer has on the ground. And they have a lot of bales. How many is that? That's 3, 4, 5, 9.
A lot.
11, 12, 13, 14, 15 bales. So they've got as many there as you can get back with the transport company.
Oh, that is a nice setup. Interestingly enough, it was called the Grimmer gliding because Grimmer invented it. So what you do is you push the upper two bales with the... Oh, no! They try a 4-stack. Cetrus is like, okay.
Oh, this could go so horribly wrong.
Bale boost. Lindner got it again. They again got what they needed to win this.
Really?
Does that work? Does that work? Is that what you're doing?
That's not gonna work!
It might! It actually might!
That can't work, surely!
Come on. That will be that way.
No! No! Oh, just... No, two of them are off.
All of them are off. Pretty much.
Two of them came off.
Interesting way to try, though. We have it to give it to Lindner. That was a good thing to try.
He was ever so slightly over to the right hand side with that top stack, and it was enough to cause half of them to fall off.
He doesn't have enough time to pick them up again, though. This bonus is there for more than a minute, and because this guy is so good and so fast, he's already running out of bales because all the bales are already delivered, so he doesn't totally have the time to go and pick them up. However, Grimmer this time, better prepare.
It was a late boost, though.
It was a late boost.
So it has played into Lintner's hands a little bit here. They are trying to make sure they've got as much grain as possible.
Yeah, but it's still way less than what Grimmer will have. So, and you can see it here, Grimmer, 34,000 liters. This thing is full to the max. There is no space left. Grimmer is like, we are not doing that bottom thing again. That is an impressive
amount of grain.
And they're only 100 points behind. So even if they are not scoring anymore, but even if they wouldn't score anymore, look at this, it's 24,000. That's 10,000
liters less. That is not good.
No, it's absolutely massive. And Grimmer is already starting.
There's less than 100
points between the teams. They are so ready. Yeah, this is big advantage, Grimmer. Only 40 points. Oh no! And Bully is stuck. If something goes wrong, everything goes wrong. This is just...
At this point, I cannot see a way that Lindner can win this.
No. I don't know how they want to come back. And they know. You can tell from the face of Cesarus. He is very unhappy. Look at this. He's like, oh, guys, this is not good. It's sad to lose it that way. It's sad to just get out-equipped, basically, in during both games. I mean, it's not over, right? There's only a 6-point difference.
And they are holding Grimmer to only a 6-point advantage on each bale. So, Lindner score now. They keep getting bales in. They will be all right for a while. But
there are not that many bales for Grimmer. Yeah, but there are not that many bales for Grimmer. So there is a chance for Lindner to come back here. However, they need to deliver bales, and they need to deliver a lot of them.
Are they actually doing any? Yeah, they are doing some bailing with the New Holland, but they're not scoring points.
No, they're not scoring points, and
they can't hold this.
No, and Grimmer has both combines both big bale presses on the field right now. They know all they need to do is deliver bales, and they all totally do it. Yeah, no, this is a nightmare. This is an absolute disaster.
It's 50 points between them, though. It is now. Can Grimmer get these bales back? This is where they were last time, and they tried to get more grain in. What they need to do is actually, as we said, if they deliver bales, they have a chance.
Absolutely. But they need to start to deliver now.
They have more bales.
And they need
to
deliver.
They have more bales kicking around than Grimmer do at the moment.
Yeah, but Grimmer does have 5, though.
They do.
That's another 115 points. So you need to come up with a solution here, and that solution has to be a lot of bales.
Yeah.
But it's not happening right now. Look at this. It's just the Anderson is not utilized to the fullest. You pick up that thing. You basically sacrifice one of your power plays for the Anderson, and then you are not utilizing it more than once. This, to me, is a mistake. You need to get this thing full twice. Just imagine having a second full Anderson. That would look very different. So,
they are stopping stuff. And why are they doing this?
They're trying that again. Losing
it's
a man.
It's a minute and a half left.
You could and, just and press
Grimmer bales. Grimmer have just got a bale pressive.
Yeah.
They've been scoring points without Lindner scoring a single point. It's going to be to a 1.9 again. A minute on the clock.
Yeah.
And Grimmer have bales coming in while Lindner are wasting time trying to even up the multiplier.
And it's a mistake we have seen so many times. If you are behind, for some reason, it comes to your mind that you need to even up the multiplier. And while this is a good idea, you know, you don't want to be in a disadvantage when it comes to the multiplier. If you know you can't exactly even it up, just get that bales. Make sure these bales are there. Make sure you get them into the barn and score points, because otherwise you won't even have more bales and you won't get more points per bale anyway. So if you have less bales and score less points with them, how are you supposed to win this?
And that 30 seconds to go and Lindner just have bales sitting there not scoring points.
Yeah, and this is over. This is the end for Lindner. Grimmer is our first game team in the semifinals. I'm sure about that. 10 seconds to go. There is a 200-point advantage. This is a very strong showing from Grimmer, though. Two games with more than 800 points. Very, very strong showing.
That is a really strong showing. And Lindner, you can see it going to pot at the end. But Grimmer take it with 811 points. That is an impressive score.
Congratulations to Team Grimmer for advancing to the semifinals. Well played from Team Lindner, though. Congratulations to our Austrian team for making it to the quarterfinals of the World Championships. This is already
look at that. 10 extra bales delivered.
Yeah, this is insane.
By Grimmer.
This is absolutely insane. So, yeah, well, Lindner's out of the tournament. They fought well. They had a good season. I'm absolutely sure we're going to see them again next season. We will see Team Lindner back. For Grimmer, the season is not over. They are not done yet. They want that trophy. And there's one thing I can promise you. The next game will be a banger, because we are watching the team that will face Team Grimmer in the semifinals. But we're going to have an interview first, of course. But let's have a very quick outlook on what's coming next. It's Krone versus John Deere.
That will be a good game.
Absolute. It could be a final, but it's a quarterfinal.
Krone showed in the group stages that they are not a team to be underestimated.
Absolutely not. Oh, are we going to go over to the interview and I'm going to try to translate what I can?
Ja, ich stehe jetzt hier mit dem Gewinnern oder einem der Gewinner. Glückwunsch nochmal.
Dankeschön.
Ja, ich glaube, die Frage, die sich jetzt jeder stellt, war das mit den drei Dreschern so geplant in beiden Spielen? Oder war die selbst überrascht, dass ihr die so bekommen habt?
Three harvesters all the time, or was it a surprise for you guys?
Was denkt ihr? Also geplant war es von uns nicht. Wir haben es rein zufällig gesehen, dass sie noch da waren. Und dann haben wir sie genommen.
Ja, also denkst du, es hat schon dafür gesorgt, dass es noch mal einen Vorteil hatte? Das Problem im ersten Spiel, es war ja ein hochpunktiges Spiel für auf beiden Seiten. Also ein bisschen überrascht, dass sie mit einem Drescher es noch geschafft haben, so viele Punkte zu bekommen? Oder?
Überrascht waren wir ja, aber haben es ja
noch nicht geschafft. Habt ihr noch ins Ziel gebracht? So many points with only one
im ersten Spiel, den Telelader, war es auch schon von Anfang an so ein Plan von euch. Im zweiten Spiel habt ihr es ja wieder anders gemacht. Was war es mit dem auf sich?
Das war so geplant.
Ja, auch. Und die Änderung dann auch, also
die Änderung war ja so, dass
stimmt, die haben ja gemacht,
but in the second time it was banned, so we couldn't pick it, but it was part of a strategy to grab the Telehandler.
Ich habe noch eine Frage zum Martin, der ist ja relativ neu dabei und auch recht jung, also ich sage jetzt mal, ist ja mein Namenskollege.
Question about Martin, the new player, the guy in the middle, he is a very young player.
Einige tausend Euro Preisgeld.
Hat
er da ein bisschen was beruhigen müssen oder hat
Could
er sich sehr schnell
eingefügt? Er ist ganz
ruhig, der Junge.
Super calm.
Der macht es auch eigentlich sehr gut.
Ja, das habe ich auch so im Chat gesehen.
No, he's already calm and he's very prepared. He knows exactly what to do.
Dann kommen wir noch, bringen wir voraus. Nächstes Spiel wird Krone gegen John Deere. Sind ja auch keine unbekannten Namen. Was denkst jetzt du so? Wer macht's und wen hättest du vielleicht lieber oder so?
It's Krone versus John Deere next. Who do you want and who you think is going to win?
Weil John Deere ist so ein Angstgegner von uns, aber...
We would love to play against Krone because John Deere always beats us.
Beide Teams habt ihr genau angeschaut.
But we're gonna take whatever it takes.
Ihr habt die Chance, ne? Genau. Gut, dann ja, ich wünsche euch viel Glück, auch allen anderen natürlich, aber jetzt erstmal feiern vielleicht noch nicht, aber wir sehen uns dann wieder. Okay, also dann gebe ich ab an die Pause und dann gehen wir zum nächsten Match danach.
And after that...
Yeah. I'm ready to play now. Put me in the game now. I came here to prove it. I'm ready to do it. I can't be afraid now. Put me on the stage now. I'm ready to rage now. I feel like an animal stuck in a cage and I'm ready to break out. So what are you afraid of? Those feelings are made of. Get in the game, your moment of fame. Show them what you made of. It's time that we stand up. It's time that we man up. For anyone asking who is the best, we putting our hands up. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. This time, like the last time, you better get ready to race to the top. I'm ready to do this, show you what the truth is. I step on the field, it's time to get real. I'm feeling so ruthless. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. Lower the lights down. Hand over my crown. Hand over my heart. I do this for my town. I do this for my crowd. So turn me up real loud. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop.
Everybody, and welcome to everybody who's watching on Twitch. And I see that our good friend DJ Goham is in the Twitch chat at the moment.
Nice. Hello, DJ Goham. Yeah. Well, Krone versus John Deere coming next. That yes. is a big one. Winner, of it course, is facing Grimm in the semifinals. So, we...
It's...
Gotta watch some replays first, of course, from the of last course. Games.
But, yeah, it's... It's an injury... It's... Krohn... We've had so many teams in the group stages coming into this who have come back and shown us that they are not teams to be underestimated, and Krohn is one of those teams.
Yeah, I mean, they finished the regular season third. They yeah. dominated their group, won that one. The only first seed group team that actually won the group. So that yeah. would be interesting. But let's have a look at the last game first. Let's have yes. a quick look at the replays. There we go.
So some interesting choices here from Lindner on trying to load those... up tails and just not quite getting it.
No, that was... I don't know what that was, but that was definitely not planned. You that's, can tell it wasn't.
That is kind of the story of their play, is that, that very little of what happened to them seemed to actually be planned.
Yeah, it was a series of unfortunate events. I think that's yes. how you can phrase it.
And very much being on the back foot. And this is so this is how that first game, when we first saw them having troubles, this was how this happened, was they didn't load that bale properly off the back of the baler, and then they didn't quite turn in correctly, and then it, yeah.
yeah.
They were sort of on the back foot from the beginning. It just did not go well for them that first game.
No, absolutely nothing worked. And, I mean, they had a strong showing in the first game. It's not that yeah. they didn't have a strong showing. It's just, as you can see here, a lot of tiny mistakes that just made everything just not work out the way they want. This is, I like how our tech is just showing it super slow, making sure, you know, that you can see here how many seconds were wasted.
Up it goes, 10 degrees.
And then the bridge is going degrees. Up. Yeah.
30 degrees. A full 45 degrees, and he's still stuck on this. And then this was the point at which I thought he's about to flip off the back of this and go nose first into the water, and it just didn't.
Yeah.
He got very lucky with the end of that, I feel.
He was. I mean, we don't know if he's lucky or if he's just a good player, but in the end, it was needed to not get stuck there. He managed to do that. It didn't change anything, though.
But it's very indicative of how the both games went for Lindner. That single replay pretty much sums everything up.
Yeah, exactly.
In that they had a good section in the middle where they got the bale boost both times, and they used it to score the maximum points during that bale boost. And then either side of it, they just didn't take advantage of anything.
Exactly.
And it seems to me that was their whole strategy throughout both games, was fill up the Anderson, get it back to our barn, and unload it during the bail boost. And what points we score in that, we score. Outside of that, we don't know what we're going to do.
Yeah. And then we improvise for another 8 minutes.
Yeah. And unfortunately, at this level, you can't do that.
No.
You can't rely on luck either side of your main strategy, because otherwise you do lose games.
Absolutely, yeah. And to be fair, I mean, if you are not getting two harvesters in the beginning, this is not a good situation.
Yeah.
Right? You are under pressure from minute one. You have to come up with a strategy for that against one of the strongest team in the league, which is hard in itself. It's just not a good position.
But I still think that is a failure of strategy. If you're not going to go for chip tuning and slight edge, you're going to be slower. And if you're going to be slower, you can't go for the John Deere and the Ideal, because the other team is going to go for those combines. They know they're faster than you, and they know that they can get them first. So you've got to go for what the other team isn't going for. And that, in that case, is the New Holland in the case. The exception I would say to that is if either of those two harvesters are on the edge.
Yeah, or if you realize...
The going to go for stuff in the middle to make sure they get something.
Or if you realize that you have just a good start. I mean, you can see the other team rushing down on the other side of the map. If you realize that you might be faster for some reason, for whatever reason, maybe they got stuck, then it works. Other than that, you have to just deal with the fact that you are not getting the fast things. But we are heading over to Martin, I guess. Yeah, we are heading over to Martin to introduce the other teams. So let's give the stage to Martin for a moment. I was wrong. Martin is coming over in a couple of seconds. 20 seconds to be absolutely exact here. So we have a couple of seconds left before we gonna introduce Krona and John Deere, but we should be ready now. So let's try again.
Ja, jetzt haben wir genug über die Angstgegner gesprochen, aber die müssen sich jetzt auch erstmal beweisen, weil so weit sind wir eigentlich noch überhaupt nicht. Denn erstmal müssen sie noch ihren heutigen Gegner aus dem Weg räumen, falls das überhaupt so weit kommt. Wir kommen zum grün-gelben Turnier, Spiel des Tages, nämlich Krone gegen John Deere. Und dann bitte ich das erste Team herein. Auf dem blauen Tisch spielt heute Krone mit STR, Marshall Maiden und ihrem Captain Dealers.
There is Team Krone.
Und dann auf dem roten Tisch spielen John Deere mit Flexo Fabio, Nullstein und Zippy 3.
Team John Deere. Number 2 seed, number 3 seed. We're going to see the statistics any second
aus,
now.
Sag ich mal. And aber ich denke, yeah, wird
this
ein
is, this,
Match.
As I said,
und,
it could be a final.
Dann schauen wir uns
it
an und ich gebe jetzt gleich mal really an die Experten.
There are only 3 teams that won one of the circuit tournaments so far. And that is the wrong statistic. They realized there are only 3 teams that won a circuit tournament so far, right? And that was Trelleborg, obviously, with winning 9 of them, Krone and John Deere. You can see it here, number 2 seed, number 3 seed, exact same amount of average base delivered, close in average points.
Head to head.
Krone never lost against John Deere.
Beat John Deere twice.
Yeah. Krone never lost against John Deere.
This is going to be a very, very interesting.
Absolutely is.
I exactly the same number of bales delivered. Very similar numbers of grain that they've delivered. Slightly more has been delivered by Krone than by John Deere, which could be a slight advantage. Although in the last game it wasn't.
I think the only reason why John Deere is above Krone in the standings is because Krone had just this gap. You know, they started very strong. And then for some reason, there were a couple of tournaments where they just didn't show up anymore. They played okay, but they never made finals again. They weren't able to dominate anyone anymore. And then at the end of the seasons, they came back. So Krone had this slump.
Good chunk of the season to come up with a new strategy after... Well, after Trelleborg started demolishing everybody's strategy, really.
Yeah, and I wonder how they play. I mean, we're going to see them afterwards, and I'm really interested to see if Trelleborg is able to play to their full potential again. But for now, this is probably the match of the quarterfinals.
Yeah.
I mean, there is Trelleborg versus VK left, and Burning Gamers by Stark versus Horsch. We're going to see these two games later on. But this is the number 2 seed versus the number 3 seed. This is two of the best teams of the league. They are both absolute league favorites. They can make it to the finals. Of course, they know each other very well. They played against each other a lot. They scrimmed a lot. This is just interesting. It is just the game of the quarterfinals. For me personally, this is the most interesting game. I'm really looking forward to
this. This is a proper grudge match, and it's I having the number three seed, having beat the number two seed twice, and the number two seed having never beaten the number three seed, does make for a really interesting match.
It absolutely does. It absolutely does. And if you think about the regular season standings, both of them finished in the top eight. No, I'm lying. Actually, John Deere finished top eight 10 times. They won two tournaments. They finished second twice, lost against, I think both of them lost against Trelleborg. Finished third or fourth 3 times and top eight 3 times as well. Krone only won one tournament. They finished second twice. They finished third or fourth 4 times, and only 2 times when they made top eight, they got kicked out in the quarterfinals. Both teams very, very strong. And again, only 3 teams were able to ever win a tournament so far. 9 times Trelleborg, 2 times John Deere, and 1 times Krone. 9 times Trelleborg is insane, by the way. You know, it's a good point to mention
that
again.
That was what I was saying earlier, is that the fact that Trelleborg have won that many times and they're not going into these finals as the favourites is really, really telling as to how badly they choked in that first game.
They're almost underdogs now. I'm not betting on them against VK, not going to lie.
No. And that's the thing. I will talk about this a lot more, I think, in the when we're approaching that game.
Absolutely, yeah, because for now we are here.
That is going to be a match. But this is again two very, very closely matched teams in John Deere and Krone. And I think that either team can take this.
Yeah, and I wonder what they do.
If I was to put my finger on one team or the other, I think I would actually put it on Krone in this. I think they're the stronger team coming into it.
So that's your prediction? Krone is winning that one?
My prediction is Krone. I think it will go 3 games, but okay. My prediction, I think,
interesting. Krone. That's very specific. I like it. I agree it will be 3 games, but I think John Deere is going to
make it. Well, I think Krone have had a hard season and have had to fight back to you know, good early section, as you said, had a middle of a season which was hard and didn't score much, and then started coming back at the end. And I think that they've had to come to these finals the hard way and maintain their third place the hard way.
Yeah, and what I think is interesting for Krone, while we see the picks and buns coming in, they are not playing with Blackjack. Last time, during the group phase, they brought Blackjack back into the starting roster. Roster. They brought Blackjack back into the starting roster. But this one is the substitute now. He's sitting out there waiting for anything to happen so that he can come in. We like to mention again, every team is able to substitute players after every match. So technically they can change. But for now, they are playing with Still Dealers and Marshall Maiden. On the other side, John Deere, of course, with their top team, Sippy, Nullstein, and the Star Stagger Flex Fabio.
No big surprises in any of these selections so far, or any of the bans, to be honest, other than the telehandler has not been banned.
Yeah, and you usually ban that one against John Deere because you know they love it, but
they've not gone for it, interestingly. No. Unless they're going for a 3 stacker setup.
No, they don't.
They're not. No, this is, yeah. So this is a very, very standard sort of set of selections.
Yeah. I'm almost tempted to say John Deere is going with the Trelleborg selection. It's the New Holland and the Valtra. They usually pick the Steyr as well, but the Steyr is always banned now because it's too good. And I expect both teams to go slight edge chip tuning here, and that's exactly what we see. Yeah. So a very, very similar setup. 2 stackers, narrow tires. Both teams have pretty much the same setup. Both teams have the same power-ups. So I expect them to try the exact same thing. Just rush down as fast as possible. Grab as many things as you can. And make sure that the other team is not getting enough. Pretty much what Grimma did before. However, I don't think it will work that well. Because both teams are just too good in it. And the ideal is on a very, very outside.
You have to be very confident of your strategy to not go chip tuning and slight edge. And here we go. So, Krone are heading for the ideal and the case. And they are also heading for, I think that was the new one.
And that was close by a second. Brown has two harvesters already. The John Deere for Team John Deere. That's good. They got also got the Fen Palace. Oh no, and he's stuck behind the press. But yeah.
Have John Deere got a? No.
No, it's all good.
For a moment, John Deere had a harvester streak. They do not.
No, they do not. Two harvesters for both teams. Actually, a very, very even. The ideal in the case on side of Krone, they're already on the field, already working. On the side of John Deere, they have the John Deere already working, and they do have the New Holland as well. That one is still outside because they are still grabbing stuff. Like Krone is like, yeah, we have everything we want. We are done here. We take what we have, and we start fighting. Flexo Fabio, at the moment, not sitting in anything. So, not Which sure is, what John Deere is waiting for, but they really need to start doing stuff. And Krone is already on their way.
Advantage is definitely here to Krone at the moment. John Deere have just a single harvester running on the field.
They had a perfect start. I mean, John Deere will have the second harvester on the field in a second now. They're just grabbing more stuff, switching tractors, because, you know, during the pick and ban phase, you usually just pick what you want, and then you switch harvesters later on. There is the second combine going on that field, but Krone is just ahead. They're faster.
But it's an interesting thing where we've seen time and time again just a couple of seconds advantage on something, or just you know, managing to get something in into the field first. That can end up being a winning thing at the end. And with that being the case, Krone at the moment are leading.
Yeah. However, John Deere does have the Krone press. Which is awesome for them. They love using that because they usually just deliver bales pretty much all game long for Flexo Fabio, who is, I can't stress this enough, one of the best stackers in the league. So John Deere does prepare everything for a close fight. He does right now with the New Holland press. That makes me question where the Fen press is.
It is with John Deere.
John Deere managed
to get the Krone and the Fen press, which is going to be a disadvantage for Krone.
But not too big, because the case press has been buffed a bit. So it is better than it used to be. So they should still be fine. Kuhn. No, it's me. That's why I'm not the expert here. I am. Kuhn, yes. Of course. I was just... I mean, I'm not native, and I try to fiddle two sentences together.
I know, but I needed to get back for earlier.
Yeah, I was about to talk to about the case harvester and the Kuhn press at the same time, and it came the case press on.
Gnome Life Matter. This is not a joke. This is
all good. All
league.
Good.
This is very serious.
Yeah, it is. And Krone is taking a very serious approach of getting bale in. We can see it here. First bale. 40 points, 40-0 for Krone, and both teams will use the first 5-6 minutes to just prepare everything, get as many bales as possible next to the conveyor belt. And I wonder if they are going for bale boost or grain boost, because I have seen both teams using both, basically.
I would expect in this game for them both teams to be going for grain boost. Both teams that have got a very similar, very even setup at the moment, and the only way we've seen it time and again, you need to disrupt the other team in order to not leave this to chance. And as a result, grain boost, getting the grain boost and getting more grain back, that is a great way to disrupt the other team.
Absolutely. So, and for Krone, because they were on the field earlier, it might even be an advantage, especially if the grain boost is coming in very early, so that John Deere has no time to catch up. That would be good for Krone. So they are hoping for early drop so that they can get the grain boost as fast as possible and make sure to get pressure onto John Deere. I agree with you. I think both teams will aim for that. So I don't think any team will be mad with the other team grabbing that. And I wonder if they both have the same idea we do. Like if the guys from Krone think that John Deere is aiming for the exact same boost, they might not even go for it, and the other way around. So we might see the boost lying around for like a couple of seconds, because both teams are like, yeah, whatever, we know what the other team is picking, so we are not wasting time on that one.
I mean, that would be a good disruption. If you presume the other team is going for the strategy you would, and you go for the other strategy, then that's going to disrupt them, because they'll be on the back foot. They'd be expecting to deliver grain for the grain boost, and you're then just delivering bales. and scoring points.
Yeah, that would be interesting. So, however, you can see that both teams still have both combines on the field. 9 minutes and about 35 seconds left, which means that they are going for a very long harvester, double harvester strategy. And that's pretty much grain boost.
That screams grain boost.
It does, but John Deere is not ready. Look at this. They are just opening up the auger wagon.
They don't have anything unloaded. They have got just over a minute left.
Yeah, and they do have the ideal, right? No, the ideal is at Krone. This is John Deere. They should still be fine as long as they start unloading soon. But they need to do something. They're a little bit slower again.
Here we go. Krone unloading the 14,000 liters in the ideal.
And the case is coming as well. You could tell at the border of your screen that the case is coming, but yeah, Nullstein, 14,000 liters, yeah, that's what he can do as well with the John Deere combine, all good.
So again, we've got very similar amounts of grain sitting in their auger wagons as well.
Interesting. But Krone is just these few seconds faster. They switch to one harvester strategy now, and that's expected after you deliver for the first time. About 20 seconds left before the drone drop can happen. And John Deere is doing the same now, switching to a one harvester strategy. They are switching to a zero harvester strategy. No one is jumping into a harvester, but they will very soon. John Deere is unloading.
You can see there the difference between getting the two harvesters on the field really quickly and starting off with one harvester. Krone were able to get unloading and switch to the other strategy that much quicker than John Deere.
Absolutely. They are like 10, 15 seconds ahead of John Deere right now.
And this is why I feel Krone is so strong at the moment, is that they have their timings down. They've been practicing this and they've been getting themselves very much to move as one very fluid machine.
Absolutely. But this can be said for all eight teams here. I mean, there is a reason why these are the eight best teams in the world. They have shown over and over again that they are really good. There is the drone. We are very way into the drone drop window already, so we are waiting for that one. And that was perfect.
That was easy going. Threading the needle there.
They don't have that many bales though. I mean, given that there are only 7 minutes left, that's what, 5, 9, that's 11 bales ready. That's not too much with 7 minutes on the clock.
Right.
I wonder how many John Deere has. We're gonna see that in a second, I guess. You can see in the upper half of the screen that the Kuhn press is out there, so more bales coming in very soon.
Looks definitely more wheat cut by Krone than by John Deere.
Yeah. And you can tell, look, both teams are just not caring about the drone. It's like, yeah, it's flying there, whatever.
Yes, whatever. I think both teams are set up in the way they're set up at the moment for whatever drops. Whatever drone drop happens, both teams are in good stead for it.
So. And that means that we are in for a very close game. Because both teams are just head-to-head playing the exact same strategy right now. Oh, preparing the exact same way.
And the power-up has dropped, and that is...
The bale boost picked up by John Deere. So now there is the time to score, and both teams are like, well, fine then. Okay, let's score.
Both teams nicely in position to score as many points as they can straight off this. This is, as said at the beginning, this is going to be a close game. It is. Both teams are doing it point for point at the moment.
Yeah, and I have to give the advantage here to John Deere, because they do have Flexo Fabio. This guy is one of the best staggers in the league, and you can tell, look at this. I mean, of course, Stur is not too bad, or STR, I'm not even sure how to pronounce his name, to be fair. But Flexo Fabio is just so quick. It's insane.
More bales coming back for Krone now, and more bales coming back for John Deere.
This is the most even game. It is almost as even as it can be. I mean, it's insane. 250 to 240. We have about a minute left on the boost. I expect both teams to end up with something about 400, 450 points. And then we have to see what's going to happen with grain. And that might be where the 15 seconds that Krone is ahead might come in. Or maybe not. Who knows? Can't happen, dude.
15 extra seconds of grain can actually be quite a large amount.
It can be. But then again, if you drop a bale like he just did, That might be one bale less delivered doing that power bonus. Wow, look at this. Flexo Fabio is so good.
That is some nice precision stacking.
This is just so smooth.
And yeah.
This is insane.
You can see the difference in the stackers. They're both great stackers, but Flexo Fabio is just...
He's just good. It's almost like... I always compare it to dancing. It's like you are having this nice bale dance and you are doing very well. This is it. The bonus
and
is
you can,
over.
And you can see the difference.
Yeah, it's 50 points
it's 50
at 4
point
John
difference.
Deere.
And
Krona was
and
ready.
And Krona there dropping the grain the moment.
And this is a very good strategy because you have seen that Krona still had bales on that belt. So
yeah.
These bales that didn't make it with the power-up bonus, they will come in with the nice little grain bonus now.
And it also has the advantage that if John Deere have any bales on the belt, immediately they go in and they score less points.
Yeah, but I don't think John Deere had any on the... And look at this. This is... It will end up with something like 2-0, 2-0 or something. Both teams are just so close to each other.
But if Krone now need to be loading bales onto that belt.
Yeah. And they will.
While they have that advantage, they have to be...
500 to 500. This is just insane.
And they are doing it.
It is a fantastic, fantastic setup. Very even game. And we can see exactly where I mentioned that Krone is 15 seconds ahead. See?
Yeah.
They did the exact same thing. They have the exact same amount of grain. Everything is back to even. But the 15 seconds Krone had were when they scored more.
Ooh.
Oh, no! That didn't work out.
That was close.
Another 10 seconds gained by Krone.
And it delays Flex Fabio.
And all bridges are up. Look at this. Oh, this one is coming down. Lucky him. Lucky him.
But that is not good for John Deere. That, again, that delays them from scoring points they need.
Absolutely do. But there are only two bales behind, right? It's just a 44-point advantage. However, these 4 points, like
look at that.
The exact 4 points in the end, that's something John Deere can't get because it's 2-0, 2-0. So they will always get 20 points per bale. So they need to have a bale more because they need to win by 16 points at least.
And Krone have a problem here. They have no bales.
They have no bales.
Bales.
Yeah, absolutely. But John Deere does not have that many either, do they? And Krone Adidas is coming in with 4 more. All good. 20 point different, 2 minutes to go. This is an absolutely insane game. This is exactly
this is
what the doctor
so
ordered.
Close.
I'm almost out of my seat here. It's
I find myself difference. Leaning closer and closer to the screen as this goes on. And there we go, another more bales going in, and it's 4 points in it.
That's the 15 seconds. These 4 points are the exact 15 seconds we were talking about. That's the advantage they have.
STR coming across.
Oh, there are nice. There are 5 more bales for STR to deliver. This is nice for them. Flexo Fabio now scoring.
Yeah.
Again, it stays at 4 points. It stays at 4 points. 1 minute 20 left.
More bales back, though, at the moment for Krone than there are for John Deere.
And STR is doing very well. This is looking very smooth. But so is Flexo Fabio. He has one more bale to deliver. And if he does, then we are at a 4-point difference again. Insane. 1 minute to go. This is the last bale for Rona for now, but they are picking up new ones. And there, John Deere is coming in with more. Oh, nice. That's another 80 points coming in right there. And you totally need that 80 points. You need that quickly.
Krone needs to deliver at least two more bales.
Oh,
right
yeah,
now.
They are coming, though. They are like, yeah, we are coming. We are on our way. You can't do that, dude. This bridge is coming up. This bridge is...
Oh, no! They didn't need that!
Why did you even follow? It was obvious.
That's not good.
No, it's not good. It's the two bales you need, and all the bridges are up now. You have to go...
20 seconds. Detour. Oh, no!
And there's John Deere coming in with 2 more bales. That will be
enough.
That will be enough.
Final 15 seconds!
They won't. It's 4 point difference.
4 point difference. Get them in the bottom.
Oh, John Deere's... Now they are 6 points ahead.
They're
still 6 points ahead.
It's going to be 6 points!
16 now. 16-point
win for John Deere in the dying moment.
That was an insane game. 16 points John Deere made it by 16 points, and that were the 40 points they didn't get because they didn't take the bridge. That's the exact two bales Krona would have needed.
Yeah, that is the exact.
And you can see it here. It's two bales less. It's exactly two bales less. Everything else is even. It is just Krona not getting in these two bales that were missing.
That is an insane match.
That was awesome. And we are in for a fantastic series. I can feel it. 1-0 John Deere. It's not over. There are hopefully two more games we're going to see.
Krone made one mistake.
Yeah. And they played it very well till the end. Insane. That's, I'm going to drink a sip. You keep talking.
Nuts. I can't. We see games do that sometimes, and it is just, yeah, absolutely nuts. Down to the last 16 points.
And we expected it to be a close game, right?
We did. Absolutely.
Oof. That was fantastic.
That was fantastic. And Krone played a blind up to that last bridge where he tried to follow through and should never have done that.
No.
They delivered their grain spot on time. They got in on the harvest first. They set themselves up perfectly. And John Deere, kudos to John Deere, they kept with them the whole way.
Yeah. It was an absolute close game. I mean, the only difference really were the 10-15 seconds in the beginning for Krona and the bridge in the end. Other than that, that was an absolute back-to-back game. Very, very close. Very, very even.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting. The next game is absolutely going to make or break for Krone. John Deere, it could go either way, though. A game that close in the first one, it just, yeah, gets a bit mad.
Absolutely, yes. And we're going to see at least one more of these. The teams are getting ready as we speak. We're going to go into game two in the next, I'd say, 10 seconds or something. So, yeah, I'm absolutely ready for game two of these.
Yeah. Game two is... I'm expecting Krone to come out fighting. They didn't lose much
at all. Absolutely not. All they need to do now is to make sure that they get the two bales in that they didn't get in. And if they do that, then they are in a good position. They need to be as fast as they were, though. They need to do that again. They need to get this everything, basically everything, just the same way they did it before, because they did it perfect.
If they play like clockwork, like they did in that last game, and don't make a mistake like that, then yeah, they can absolutely take this.
Yeah, they absolutely can. And we see pretty much the same bands, don't we? The Steyr is still in. That will change now, I guess. Yeah, there it is.
There we go.
Steyr is gone. The next two picks will most likely be I expect the New Holland and the Valtra to come in or something, maybe the Case.
Or maybe the Massey.
There is the New Holland. And let's see what Krone goes for.
They go for the Massey.
They go for the Massey.
So, that's a complete switch around from the last game.
Pretty much.
Yeah, there's the Vent Favorite.
Where is the Valtra? Expected to come now. Yep, there it is. And now narrow tires on both. That's what I expect. I don't see anyone changing their system. No, there is the narrow tires for John Deere.
And then the narrow tire Case on the last choice.
Yeah, I expected that one to be picked earlier, but there it is. Chip tuning slide edge. As said, I mean, neither team has a reason to change anything. John Deere won with that tactic, so they are like, yeah, let's do that again. And Krone know that they only needed one better, you know, second in the bridge to win that one. So they won't change anything either. Exact same setup, exact same strategy. I expect this game to be pretty much the same, given that the rushdown to the equipment now will play out the same way they did before. I mean, maybe something changes, but if the harvesters are 2-2 again, then we might see pretty much the same. Here we go. Where is the good stuff? Where is the ideal? Oh, the ideal is right there in the center. Very nice. Krona is...
Three combines in the middle.
Yeah, Krona is trying to get the ideal and the New Holland, and they will. They are faster. John Deere is grabbing the case. So now is the question, who gets the John Deere combine? That is a very important question to ask.
Looks like that is John Deere.
It is John Deere, yeah. It is John Deere. John Deere has the Fendt press as well.
Two harvesters...
John Deere is grabbing the Fendt and the Krona again. Yep. So pretty much the same setup we've seen before. The New Holland is on side of Krona, and who does have the Kuhn? Probably Krona as well. So yeah, same setup.
And again, John Deere are delayed putting their second harvester into the field. I suppose it worked for them last time. They're just going to run with it again this time.
It did, and yeah. Ooh. The Krona press is in a very interesting position here.
Yeah, there we go.
Doesn't really matter. Fixed. So, yeah, pretty much the same start we have seen before. Krona ahead by like 10 seconds again, having both harvesters on the field earlier. John Deere, yeah, well, trailing. However, we have seen how that played out last time. It's not much of a difference. Not between these games or these teams. There we go, the Krona press on the way.
First bales coming out for John Deere here in the Krona press.
Yeah, and I wonder if Krona is going for first bale again. They did it last game, and they really needed that one. Again, they would have won because of the way they were faster, and because of the first bale, of course, because first bale counts double. We shouldn't forget that. Twice the amount of points, so... Absolutely need that first bale. It's very, very important. It's one of the most important things for Krona to ensure that they keep, but stay ahead of the curve, because John Deere is behind them. And
as we saw last time, had John Deere got the first bale, their lead would have been bigger at the end of the last game. Yeah, it would have taken more than two bales to. In the bottom to have won that.
Absolutely. So where is the first bale coming in? Dealers is on his way. I'm not sure about. Let me have a quick look at the minimap. The John Deere guys are on their way as well, but it seems that Krona is a little bit faster again. They are just the faster team today. They are not winning, but they're faster. So there's that. That bale is going in. That should be first bale. Krona, 40 points on the clock in a second or two. Come on, give me that juicy 40 points. There it is. First bale Krona, 40-0.
What little advantage there is right now, that is sitting with Krona.
Yeah.
They've got both their harvesters on the field first. They've got first bale. And there are other advantages that John Deere have. For example, they do have this Krona bale press. It means that they're able to... bring more bales back at once. They also have the Fendt one, which means that they can create bales quicker as well. So, yeah. It's very evenly matched right now.
It is very evenly matched again. Five bales coming in for John Deere, and that's what they're all fighting for. The World Championship Trophy. That's a nice shot. I like it.
That is a very nice shot.
There we go. Dealers on the field. That's the New Holland press, obviously. Yeah, it's yellow.
He's got one bale sitting in the back there now and is well on his way to creating a second.
Both teams.
No bales on the front. He'll try and bring four back.
Yeah, both teams are again in the preparation phase. The first 5, 6, maybe 7 minutes of the game, you spend usually your time preparing everything. You have two harvesters out on the field making sure that you get as much grain into the auger wagon as possible to ensure you can have a high bonus later on. Usually teams switch it to a one harvester tactic around the 10 to 9 minute marks. We have seen both teams staying in two harvesters longer last time. I expect them to do that again to make sure that they get a little bit more grain in.
Yeah, if either team can get that little bit more grain in than the other, then they will disrupt them. It's Even a 0.1 advantage on the boost, on the bonus at the top, on the multiplayer, sorry.
Between these two teams, point one is almost a win. Yeah, absolutely is. Look at that. Nullstein is doing what he did before. The John Deere is getting nice and full. 11,800 in there right now, and it's not done yet. The auto wagon isn't even open. So
we're expecting about 14,000 liters for them to unload the combines.
Yeah, pretty much.
A good amount for each team to do.
Zippy will pretty much open up now. Yeah, he does.
There we go. As he's going past.
He needs to because the John Deere is almost full, and then you waste time if you can't unload it. So putting the auger wagon out, back to the crone press, and continuing what he did before, making sure he has as many bales as possible ready to score in a minute or two, or maybe five. Who knows? Because drone drop time starts in a minute 10, but you know, sometimes we see it coming very late. Focused faces, crone team is ready. And look at that, 14,800, 14,900. That ideal is...
They unloaded, and look at how much more wheat Krohn has harvested than John Deere at this point.
They were faster. But that 14,100 liter.
And that's yep. There we go. That John Deere harvester is full. So there's the advantage of the ideal. The ideal is able to go that much longer before it unloads.
But it wasn't it wasn't well played by John Deere. I mean, he should have known that he's almost full, and he was very far away from the auger wagon, losing a couple of seconds by just driving around a full combine. Same for Krohn, of course. The New Holland was full, and while they were far, far away from where they should be. So interesting choice. That is something usually teams do better. Usually they know exactly when
five
they have to be there.
5 seconds to the drone drop window opening.
And here's the drone. You can see it on the bottom right. Well, now in the middle of the screen. And Krohn is unloading that very full ideal.
That is, yeah. That is a very, very full harvester. If that harvester is full, that is going to be a full auger wagon. And that will be a bad piece of news for John Deere.
Absolutely. That really will. I mean, the ideal is able to hold more than 17,000 liters, and it looked very well full to me.
It did. I don't see a reason for him to have come out and unloaded in the middle of a row like that unless he was full.
No, it was full. So that means 17,000 liters there. They had the New Holland as well, right? That would be another 14,000-ish liters. So that would bring them up to 31,000 something. That's a lot.
That is a lot. That is a
look at that. That field is just done. Like this half of the field completely empty. Harvested. Done here.
I'm amazed at how much Krohn are able to harvest.
Yeah, it's insane. This auger wagon
they are really good at knocking that down. And they should really get a massive bonus for it. They will.
There are the drone drops. There are the drone drops. And they go for the grain boost, but
it's the bale boost.
John Deere was faster grabbing the bale boost. That is not what Krohn wanted. They wanted the grain boost, you can tell. However, they should be able to deal with it. STR is not that far away. And now Flexo Fabio is just not as precise as he used to be.
That is let Krohn back in this on this boost. That absolutely has let Krohn back in. They did not want to do that.
No. Still a huge advantage for John Deere. Krohn is not even able to deliver. They weren't in position. So they are losing out on lots of points here. STR knows that and tries to be as fast as possible. As long as you get pretty much all these bales on the belt before the bonus runs out, you are still fine. Because, I mean, yes, the other team is faster, but if you deliver everything you can deliver, it doesn't really matter how much time is left. Right.
I think keep an eye out here on Krohn doing what they did last time, immediately delivering their grain to the delivery point the moment this boost ends.
They will be ready, and all they can do now is to try to get as many points on that conveyor belt as possible while being behind, because John Deere was faster this time. And you can tell they are. That's 330 to 190. And there are about 30 seconds left. So as long as STR is doing well with these bales, it shouldn't be too bad. Flexo Fabio.
He has doing enough bales there to
at least keep it close.
Yeah.
And then we have to see what they do. However, I'd say that is a huge advantage for John Deere. Because they were ready when Krone wasn't. That is a situation you really don't want to be in when the boost stops. And that is in 2 seconds from now.
They have 33,000.
33,000 for John Deere. But Krone is already unloading.
They are already ready. So John Deere are on the back foot here again. But Krone need to take advantage of this and make sure they are delivering as many bales they can while they have this increased bonus.
Yeah, and they need to keep that bonus up for as long as possible, so they need to stop somewhere there. But look at that. They are way behind right now. 370 to 470. John Deere just utilized that boost very, very well. And that is a huge advantage for the green and yellow team.
It looks like this time what has sunk it for Krone has actually been not getting the boost they wanted.
No, they expected to get the right boost. They didn't get the right boost. So they are on the back foot here. 50 points lead for John Deere. And if they play it right, they should be able to take that lead and keep it till the end of the game. However, there are still more than 3 minutes left, right? And now it's only a 1 point difference. So everything can happen, especially if Flexo Fabio... Oh, no, it's not Flexo, it's Zippy. Especially if Zippy is just hitting the conveyor belt like this. But still, one belt made it. Nullstein grabbing another bale press to ensure they get more bales because they need to keep that advantage up.
It could be a one-point game. How many bales, though, Krone can get back?
Yeah, they need to be fast now. I mean,
they do. And unfortunately, they don't have the bales to match.
No. Let's have a look at the minimap. No, both bale presses are still somewhere on the field. The John Deere guys looking very focused right now, trying to keep that bale flowing. You can see it here. There are, what is that, five more bales? It's five more bales. That was an interesting way to do it. Dealers, you need to deliver. Well, there's 2 minutes 30 left, so there is still a lot of time. It's a 9-point game right now. Flexo Fabio making sure that this difference is going up again.
Bale for bale deliveries here. And it's just, and John Deere bringing in more bales.
Yeah, that's a very, very nice play from John Deere. The bales are running out. There is nothing left. Oh, no, there are more. And then again, they are running out. Nothing left. Oh, no, there are more. Doing it all the time. And that is fine. Krone, however, you know, they have a lot of bales and they are pushing.
And they are keeping up. They are able to keep those bales coming in. Again, only a 9-point difference at this point.
2 minutes left.
Just under 2 minutes. But more bales there at the moment for John Deere.
And Krone is taking the lead again, but John Deere will take it back in a minute.
Yeah.
There we go.
9 points and John Deere with more bales. In fact, John Deere have been dropping bales off the conveyor. Here comes Zippy with four more bales.
This is interesting. This will be a close game again.
Yeah, it is. I think the trouble at the moment is that Krone can't supply as many bales back as John Deere are.
No, they can't. And you can tell that they are falling behind. They need more bales. I mean, they're doing fine, but John Deere is just having bales all the time. Flexo Fabio doesn't have a single second where he's not delivering bales. Same for Krone, pretty much, but they are still behind. So
I don't see a very large mistake here from Krone that's caused this gap. I think it is just that John Deere have outplayed them.
Yeah, it was the bale boost, really. When the bale boost came in, Flexo Fabio was already sitting at the conveyor belt using all the seconds for the points, while Krone was not. STR was still somewhere on the field. He had to drive all the way to the conveyor belt,
losing
10-15 seconds.
That's why I would go for that being John Deere outplaying them rather than...
Absolutely, and that means that... I'd say, because there are no bales left, That it is. That is it. John Deere will win that one, advance to the semifinals, and face Grimmett tomorrow.
Which just goes to show what I know.
And there we go. John Deere won that one 2-0. Congratulations to the boys in green and yellow. Well fought, Krone. It was an amazing match. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough. So
that 2-0 score, that 2-0 score line does not tell the story of how close those two games were.
Absolutely not. It absolutely didn't.
Look at that. Two extra bales delivered for John Deere. And John Deere actually delivered more wheat.
Yeah.
Which is incredible.
It's not that much, though.
And it just, not by hugely, but it does show how John Deere were outplaying Krone completely during that second game.
Yeah, that was a good match. That was fun to watch.
That's just, and I hold my hands up. I did predict a 2-1 win there to Krone and got it completely wrong.
Yeah. however, I mean, who could have told? You know, it was a very close game, and we will have an interview in a few seconds with the winning team, of course, of John Deere. I'm going to translate it again. So this is my time to shine and your time to have a break, Alex, because we are on a break afterwards. Let's head over to the interview and see what John Deere has to say.
Ja, also ich weiß nicht, ob ihr den Film Fünfte Element kennt. Da kommt immer die Frage, wie grün, ich sage jetzt heute einfach mal, John Deere grün war das Match. Ne? Wir haben uns ja vor dem Spiel mal unterhalten, eben genau über diese, was ist so für dich immer die anstrengendste Phase im ganzen Spiel eigentlich, oder die konzentrierteste. Da hast du gesagt, das ist 6-8 mit den Drone Drops. Und ich habe so das Gefühl, das war
the game,
heute auch
about what is
so,
the toughest time in the game. And he's like, John Deere said, it's drone drops. Is that what happened today?
Were
the drone drops basically changing the outcome of the game?
Ja, hat so funktioniert, wie wir uns vorgestellt haben. Wir wussten, dass die Krone-Jungs den Ideal haben, was eigentlich aktuell so ein bisschen der beste Drescher im Spiel mit ist.
Yes, it worked like we wanted it to. We know Krone got the ideal. You can utilize it a lot for grain boost. And we do have Flexo Fabio, which is a fantastic stacker. So
we wanted the bale boost, basically. Dass wir dann die
Practice
können
und Drone
dann,
play a lot
ich, das war,
over the last weeks.
Glaube ich, so der Knackpunkt, wo wir dann das Spiel gewonnen haben, weil wir Ballen boosten.
And that's exactly why we won the game in the end.
Ja, also ich weiß, wir haben jetzt heute Morgen mal gesprochen und da hast du so gesagt, ja, den Drone-Drop bekommen und dann das Programm runterspielen und hoffentlich gewinnen. Ja. Beim ersten Spiel ist mir doch schon ein bisschen aufgefallen, so am Ende, es war, ich glaube, da war ein bisschen Nervosität drin. Es war ja nicht nur bei euch, also es war echt verdammt knapp und ich würde sagen, Krone war auch sehr, sehr nah dran. Da war noch die Brücke, die hochgegangen ist. Ansonsten hätte es vielleicht wirklich ganz anders ausgesehen. Das könnt ihr euch später noch mal anschauen in der Wiederholung. Also da war der schon sehr knapp dran. Aber was geht dir das durch den Kopf in den letzten Sekunden so?
Ja, was geht so, durch den Kopf?
Game was very, very close, especially because Krone almost won it.
Ich habe den Ballen hochgelegt. Hat der Fabio dann schon gleich gemeint. How wird wahrscheinlich
did you feel?
Haben wir dann nur gedacht, hoffentlich geht er hoch. Aber gut, er ist dann gefallen und das haben wir aber unten auch noch mit rein. Das mit der Brücke, muss ich ehrlich sagen, das habe ich gar nicht mitbekommen.
Mm. Ob mir yeah, and he's like, I didn't see Krone going, getting
aber
stuck
so,
in a bridge or something.
Ja,
just had to get in bales, and
Ort,
that worked very well.
Halt wieder dieser 3-3 face-to-face vor Ort ist.
We're gonna check it later.
Das hat ein bisschen gefehlt und das gibt halt dann doch nochmal ein bisschen so Zusatznervosität.
Yeah. We were missing playing face-to-face, 3-3, and it's good to be back with all the cameras.
Schiebt ihr da ein bisschen rüber zu den anderen, dann seht ihr
euch
vollkommen konzentriert bei euch.
Witzigerweise habe ich immer nach hinten geguckt, weil normalerweise, wenn wir irgendwo anders waren, war immer hinten die Leinwand.
Ah, ja, ja.
Und dann konnte man immer so ein bisschen gucken, so, was die anderen machen. Oder wenn irgendwie ein Raunen war, dann hat man geguckt, was sie machen. Aber so hast du halt von den Gegnern diesmal gar nichts mitbekommen.
Also ich habe versucht, mir das alles wegen aufzuschreiben, was da passiert ist. Und vielleicht sehen wir es in der Wiederholung. Ich glaube nämlich, sie haben sich eigentlich selbst blockiert. Ich glaube, es wollten zwei über die Brücke drüber fahren,
okay,
und dann ist es hochgegangen. Aber das sehen wir vielleicht dann in der Wiederholung nochmal. Also ich glaube, das
hätte
vielleicht
explains
gleich now
that,
aber ich will jetzt euren Sieg nicht schmälern.
Krone
weiter.
Had the problem with the bridge in the very last seconds of the game and therefore couldn't deliver the
Natürlich.
Ja, Halbfinale.
Nein, nein, so meine ich es nicht. Meine ich so, dass ihr müsst doch noch gegen Grimmie spielen.
Martin was like, Grimmie mentioned that. They're scared of you, so Taktik, is that the final for you?
Du wirst die Taktik ja, gut, nicht verraten.
You have another tactic?
Ihr seid ja der Angstgegner, aber ich schätze jetzt die Chancen ein.
And you're just like, well, we're not talking about tactics also, right now.
Ja, sag mal so,
what's your chance?
Was die Grimmie-Jungs jetzt über die letzten Turniere gemacht haben, ab Leipzig, das war definitiv nicht schlecht, das war schon sehr gut, vor allem hat man
sich very strong starting in Leipzig, they were just insanely strong.
Ein bisschen gut yeah. geärgert haben, die mussten sich auch ordentlich strecken.
Aber shot against Trelleborg as well. 50-50 they were able to, denke, you know, Trelleborg was able to win.
Gegen uns und,
so, yeah. He feels that the chances are 50-50 to beat Grimmie tomorrow.
Ich dachte mir halt so, sie haben sie euch zwar als Angstgegner genannt, aber ganz ehrlich, ich habe auch ein bisschen rumgefragt vorher und ein paar haben sogar Grimmie als Favorit mit auf dem
klar.
Papier, also definitiv. Aus Turnierfavorit. Also
definitiv.
Ich bin auf morgen gespannt. Ich wünsche euch viel Glück.
Martin mentioned that a couple of people Spiel. Think that Grimmie ja, might ja, be the tournament favorite.
Und Trelleborg. Und da gebe ich das mal nochmal ab in die Pause.
And yeah, the next game. Yeah. I'm ready to play now. Put me in the game now. I came here to prove it. I'm ready to do it. I can't be afraid now. Put me on the stage now. I'm ready to rage now. I feel like an animal stuck in a cage and I'm ready to break out. So what are you afraid of? Those feelings are made of. Get in the game, your moment of fame. Show them what you made of. It's time that we stand up. It's time that we man up. For anyone asking who is the best, we putting our hands up. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. This time, like the last time, you better get ready to race to the top. I'm ready to do this, show you what the truth is. I step on the field, it's time to get real, and I'm feeling so ruthless. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. Lower the lights down. Hand over my crown. Hand over my heart. I do this for my town. I do this for my crowd. So turn me up real loud. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. That was a game.
That was huge.
That was absolutely massive. Yeah, that was nice. So we are done with the upper half of the bracket. Looking down to the lower half of the bracket, we're going to see VK and Trelleborg next. However, we will have a look at game one of Krone versus John Deere again and get some replays in a second. While they are prepared, we are sitting here. Alex, how do you feel about... about the semifinals now, Grimmie versus John Deere. Is that something you wanted to see?
Yeah, Grimmie versus John Deere, I think, is a big match. Grimmie have come on a long way. They are, as I said earlier, they are the favourites for this.
Yeah.
And I think John Deere is going to be a big challenge for them. And I think that John Deere could easily take it because John Deere have the form.
Yeah, and that will be interesting. Tomorrow at noon German time, the first semi-final will be that one. And we're going to have a quick look at what happened in game one of Krone vs. John Deere. There we go. This is STR. No, that's Who is it? No, it's STR. I was right. It's STR. Yes.
Yeah,
with
yeah,
not so precise bail delivery. And this is, yeah, this is what made things bad for Krone in the end. They weren't able to really utilize the bonus. I mean, they were leading there, but in the end, and we
and
know that.
This is the why.
Yeah,
why
that,
did he try
that,
and follow
that,
across like that?
This is the exact second where games get lost. I mean, this one, not because there was John Deere, but this is exactly what happened to Krone in the very end of the game, and that is when Krone lost that match. Because you can see they were always ahead, there was always this 4-point difference for Krone, everything was fine, and then in the very, very end, they weren't able to cross that bridge as they should have, and then they just lost. This is just sad, because that bail should have been on top.
Yeah.
And then it would have been fine.
That would have been fine. And there was a second bail behind it as well.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's, yeah. It really was that failure to get across that final bridge for Krone and then not being able to get both of those bails.
Absolutely.
It cost them that match.
But let's look ahead now. We have a very, very interesting matchup. Let's talk very quickly about these two teams. Team 1, I mean, everyone knows the Borg, right? It's Team Trelleborg. Oh. They won 9 out of the 11 tournaments they played, finished second only once, and I think they finished fifth once. But yeah, they won 9 out of 11 tournaments, but they choked in group stage. On the other side is VK.
Up until that group stage, I would have absolutely gone, it's going to be Trelleborg.
Oh yeah, absolutely. But they have to show up now. I have to cut us self a little bit short here, because Martin will introduce the two teams. So we're going to watch Trelleborg and the Czech powerhouse VK coming in a second.
This should be good.
Ja, da muss ich mir das Mikrofon auch anmachen, würde ich mal sagen. Okay, jetzt auch
There's Team
Tschechien,
VK, I think,
Reno,
I think was off.
Und Captain Ventil.
Yeah, VK, nice little new jerseys created for the World Championships. Like it.
Und am roten Tisch spielen dann, ja, die momentan an Nummer 1 gesetzten, würde ich sagen.
And on the other side, the Fallen Titans,
Lucas,
I have to
Simon,
say. There they are, in Trelleborg. Of course, with the best setup they can have. It's Lucas is back. He's still there. Let's phrase it that way. Simon and Felix, aka Rablix. Yeah. So Trelleborg with the perfect setup, and you can see it here, right? Number one seed. Average base delivered 31. Average grain 35,000. Average points 684. 90% win rate. They won 40 out of their 42 games they played.
They only lost 2.
This is the most insane statistic you can find in the league. They are the best team by far in the league. However, they are not doing World Championship. I just not. But yeah, they lead
and
every
also,
single
also,
statistic.
This is the first time Trelleborg and VK have ever come head to head.
Because VK is a new team. They are only here for like 4 tournaments or something. They made it into the top 16 by finishing 11th, which is great given that they only played 3 or 4 tournaments. But that also shows how strong they are. You know, if you have a team that only plays 3 tournaments and finishes 11th, you know that you can expect all of them. They have an impressive
win rate. If there was going to be an upset, it's going to be this game.
And I don't feel it's an upset anymore. That's my point. If Trelleborg loses that one, I'm not even sure I would consider it an upset. They lost against Team of Elite guys during the group stage.
It is very true. And I see where you're coming from with that. I think VK are an incredible team. Everything I've seen of them has been incredible. And but at the end of the day, they're still a team that's only done 4 or 5 tournaments.
Absolutely.
And against Trelleborg, who have that 40-game win and only
40 games
over
won.
The whole season.
They played 11 tournaments out of the 12 that existed and won nine. Nine of them.
Their two losses were in the group stages coming into this and one final.
Against John Deere.
That has got to give them a really strong lead going.
Yeah, well, if they are back in form, and I would expect that they practiced a lot during the last 4 weeks since the group stage happened. If they are back into form, they are the favorites, right? They are the number one team to win it all, but they have to be the Trelleborg of old. They can't be the Trelleborg of group stage.
I think the VK are going to give them a really good run for their money. It wouldn't surprise me at all, actually, if VK beat them the first game.
I wouldn't be surprised if VK wins it. Not going to lie. Yeah. There is a high chance that VK is winning that one. They are very strong. They practice with JCD, which is the Czech team that didn't make it into the finals. But they are super strong. Their coach is actually Jose from JCD. Being with them, giving them a couple of hints because they play Trelleborg a lot. So VK is prepared. They are very, very prepared. Alex doesn't know what to say.
I don't. I'm at the point where so much has happened that's been a surprise since the start of the group stages that I'm kind of doubting myself a little bit. The saying I've gone with most of this season, though, is that you can't defeat the Borg. The Borg are a force of nature in this.
They are. And I expect them to be a force again. Not going to lie. Yeah. I don't think we're going to see group stage Trelleborg. I expect to see offline event Trelleborg. And
we've seen Trelleborg as well go in and they did. They actually did it in the group stages. They lost that first group stage game and then they came back and you saw them absolutely massacre Team of Elite Guys the second time round.
Absolutely. They are more than ready. There is no doubt about it. And as I said, I think
that they could quite possibly lose the first game to VK because they've never played VK before. And therefore, they're not used to their tactics. They're not.
Yeah, but neither is VK. And not gonna lie, well, if you get run over by Trelleborg, you usually get run over bad.
True.
You
know? But what we've seen time and again is the way that Trelleborg, the two times Trelleborg has actually lost and the few games they've lost and then come back has been somebody's come in, they've used a new tactic against.
And they better come up with something here because shit is about to hit the fan. Trelleborg is on the field and I like seeing the guys back on stage. I mean, they have been good doing online tournaments, but they are insane on offline tournaments. Yeah. And this is the biggest offline tournament.
The other thing to take into consideration, we haven't had an offline tournament like this.
4 months now. Yeah. 4 months now. Well, interesting choice of bans here, isn't it?
Yeah, that's banning the Massey. The Trelleborg don't tend to go.
No, they never use that one. This ban is just. I think they try to force leaving something open here. Like the Deutz is open, the Steyr is open. There are a couple of good things, and I expect VK to force Trelleborg to pick one of them. And they're not even going for the Steyr. It's insane. What are they doing?
What's the new one?
This is an interesting strategy already. Yeah, of course, Trelleborg is going for the New Holland. You need Lucas on that blue tractor. Lucas is on that blue tractor, that is his comfort zone. That is the best thing you can get. They will most likely take the Steyr now or the Deutz. Make sure that they get one of these powerhouses. There is the Deutz.
Yeah,
that thing is just insane. It is the best big tractor in the game. Very fast, very versatile.
There's
and then
the
Steyr of the other side. Yeah, and I expect something coming in here with a front loader again. Yeah. There we go. Oh. It's the we haven't seen that one so far.
Seen that John Deere for a very long time.
Yeah, it has to be tournaments. I don't even know if I have a statistic of when we have seen that one last. Yeah, chip tuning slide edge should be the obvious choice for both teams.
If you don't go chip tuning slide edge against Trumbull, you've lost.
Yeah, because they are the massive rush.
And probably by a rush as well.
I remember when we patched out back in the days, like after Gamescom, I think. We changed the game so that rush is super hard to do, and we were like, during the very first game of Trelleborg, we were like, yeah, well, you know, we can't see them rush anymore. Rush has changed. Rush is super hard. Trelleborg won by rush. And we were like, wait, yeah. How could that even happen? They are the masters of being fast. They are the fastest team in the league. There is a reason why they deliver that many bails.
It's the reason why the only way you win against Trelleborg is you disrupt them. You can't just outplay them.
Yeah, it's very hard to do. And there we go. Let's see
DK
what they aim for.
Immediately going, ignoring the John Deere, going for the case and the chrome.
Yeah, Trelleborg obviously going for the Fend press because that's their favorite. Oh, they got the John Deere and the ideal. This is a very good start for Trelleborg. They got exactly what they wanted.
Where is the New Holland? So
oh my
this
God,
is VK.
It's still open. No, and no, that means Trelleborg got three harvesters here. They got
BK
the new one, and
trouble.
They didn't want to get that one. You can tell they didn't want to get that one. They weren't aiming for it. They just realized, no, that thing is still open. Why is it? Oh, well, you know what? I take it. Fine. If it's open, why not? So, Krone Press on the side of VK. Okay. The Fend Press, however, on the side of Trelleborg. That's exactly what they wanted. Trelleborg also got the New Holland Press. I'm not sure who got the Kuhn, to be fair. I think it's on the side of VK. So, presses 2-2. And, that is mean. That is a Trelleborg tactic that is just the meanest shit ever. They do that a lot. They attach the press, but they're not driving down. They don't have to. They don't have to. It's yours. Unless you release it. Unless you release it, the other team can't pick it. I mean, you are sacrificing a tractor for it, right?
Yeah.
That Deutz is not usable right now. Because if
but
you try to use
they
it...
they don't need...
No, they will drive it down later. They just attach it and go to the harvesters, use two harvesters to be on the field, and leave the Deutz. And that is what Trelleborg does.
And you can see
best.
VK is on
things.
The back foot because their single harvester is also a long way behind.
Yeah, absolutely. They are probably still confused on what happened with the bear presence. Like, how could they take all these things so quickly? And you know what? I expect this to be a tactic we're going to see a lot now because all the other teams are watching. Most of them are like,
grab a baler, lock onto it like that, and then run and grab the harvester.
Yeah, it's very clever. You have to pick a baler that's next to a harvester, jump out of the tractor and run all the way over. So in an ideal world, the harvester is to the right of the baler, so that you can jump in right away. You're not losing time because it is a very risky strategy to do, because you are losing time.
Absolutely have to do here. They are going and grabbing the first bail point.
Yeah, and they have to go for bail boost. But here's the thing: do you want bail boost against Trelleborg and Lucas? No one wants bail boost against Lucas. However, if you go for grain boost, you are doomed because Trelleborg has three harvesters. So you have to go with bail boost and hope that you are better than Lucas. And this is hard to do because this guy is a monster stacker. He is the best stacker of the league. He's just a fantastic player. And very, very tough times for VK in game one here. But
every single bit of straw VK now has to get bailed up and get back because they have to be ready for that bail boost and they can. They have two bailers running. So they are able to just keep those bales flowing.
Absolutely.
They can't create the straw at the same rate as Trelleborg,
no.
But they can make sure that there is no straw on the field.
And they have to hope for an early drone drop, so that Trelleborg is not ready to deliver grain, and then they have to hope that they get the bale boost. You know, things have to just click for VK now. They're on the back foot. They need to make sure that things click, and that means that they need to spend time trying to get these things sorted. So as soon as we reach drone drop window, I expect VK to have one player staying close to the drone or stay together as three, making sure that the drone drop is in your favor. Because if it's
and
not
they,
in your
they
favor,
have the spare they have the spare player to do that at the moment. Oh no, that's
not good. These bridges for people who watch us for the first time are interlinked, meaning that one of the Treaderborg guys has just crossed that bridge on their side of the field, so it's going up for VK as well. So he couldn't. Again, a couple of seconds lost. That in a game where you're on your back foot already, that's not good. Treaderborg, I'd almost say that is the Treaderborg of old. That is exactly what you expect from this team.
The trouble VK have at the moment is that they're spending all of their time and all their energy trying to make up for the being a harvester down compared to Treaderborg. That means they have nothing in there that allows them to disrupt Treaderborg's play. Treaderborg can just play through now and they will win just playing through like that.
Absolutely. Treaderborg just needs to do what Treaderborg does, play Treaderborg, basically.
And that's the trouble with going into a game with Treaderborg where you are a harvester down. Don't have anything there that you can play against them with.
Well, we shouldn't forget that the I think wasn't the one game Treaderborg lost against Grimmer. Wasn't that where Grimmer only had one harvester? I have to check again, but I think there was a situation where Treaderborg lost with three harvesters, but I don't think
Grimmer, as far as I know, are maybe the only team I know of that have won with one harvester.
And I think it was against Treaderborg. I'm quite sure it was against Treaderborg. So it is possible.
How I wasn't screaming that from the rooftops, I don't know then, because that would be huge.
Yeah, we would have to go through the old data. However, again,
it is possible to win.
It is absolutely possible to win with one harvester. You
have seen it.
Everything has to click, as I said. It needs to work out for you. You need to just keep pressing bales. You need to keep delivering bales because you are not getting the better bonus. You can't just hit bridges with your Krone Baler.
No.
But yeah, no harm taken here. All good. Yeah, these guys are pretty nervous, I'm quite sure. I mean, you are on the big stage. People are watching. People around the world are watching. And your opponent is Treaderborg, which, you know, prior
and
to
it is,
the
it
group
is very
stage
different.
Starting.
It is very, very different being.
And now they grab it. Look at that. Now they grab it. It's 7 minutes into the game. Seaman is like, you know what? Let's just take that Baylor.
Let's go grab that now. We've got enough straw on the ground. We know we've produced more. More grain.
Yeah, and he brings the Deutz down to the field, of course, because that tractor is just super fast, super strong. You want to have that one into your in your team. So the Deutz is out there now. After 7 minutes, the Deutz will be on the field. I expect that John Deere to stay on the field, though, because, bale delivery, basically.
Yep.
And we are very well into drone drop territory. 7 minutes 30 to go. The drone drop should happen in the next 90 seconds. Well, it not only should, but it will happen in the next 90 seconds.
A late drone drop will play to VK's advantage. It means that the extra grain Treaderborg have, they can take advantage for less time. And interestingly, I think Treaderborg might have slightly less bales back.
It might look like it, but they have slightly more Lucas in their team.
But there is that, and we need to remember that they've only just started running with their second baler.
Absolutely, and we shouldn't forget here that once the drone drop happens, if that one is grain boost, and I swear Treaderborg is aiming for that one, if that one is grain boost, then it doesn't even matter. Then
yeah.
Treaderborg is just in the strongest position ever. And VK knows that. Look at that. They are not even waiting anymore. Are they actually delivering bales even before the drop happens? Are they? There is
power
the power
have
up drop.
And it
and
is the bale boost.
By VK. That is what they needed. That is exactly what they needed. Now they
and
need to do the
why,
impossible
that
and
is
out
why
bale.
VK was loading bales onto the thing.
Yeah, it worked very
they were
well.
Predicting.
And now they need to outstack basically Lucas. Good luck with that. Lucas has a lot of bales and Lucas is doing Lucas things here. That's exactly how it usually looks when he plays like this. He is just insane. However, Ventil is very, very good. So
there's 60 points between, no, 70 points between them at the moment. 100 points between them now.
Yeah, but Lucas has a lot of bales left, so this is going to shrink. There is a minute left. BK has a lot of bales as well. Interesting. Very, very interesting. It was exactly what they needed to do on the side of BK.
And it was a pretty late drop for the bonus as well.
Yeah.
BK, but that might, BK's that might next be... thing needs to be to do what was being done in the last match. They need to immediately drop their grain the moment...
Yeah, they need to get at least a second of advantage from the grain, because Trelleborg will have the stronger bonus.
And you
there's
can
no
see
question
they are
about
heading
it.
For it now. They've got 44 seconds.
Yeah, but so
and
is
in
Simon.
Fact, Trelleborg are already getting themselves in position for it as well. They want to take full advantage of the extra grain they have.
Did you see how full that auger wagon is? Yeah. As soon as Trelleborg is starting to load bales, load grain into that silo. Look at this. This is nothing. 12,000 liters. 12,
and they've got not got enough time to empty that combine. They are going to be on the back foot again. And look, there they go.
But look at that difference. I mean, yeah, Trelleborg has to go all the way around because they don't have narrow tires. But they do have the Deutz. That one is fast. So they are still
ahead.
Faster. And it's only a 10-point difference. That is not enough. Nope. That is not enough. 10 points. Or not even! In the very last second, Trelleborg scored and they are now 10 points ahead. And they do have the grain boost. And they do have the full auger wagon. And they do have the bonus coming up. And they do have everything they need. So, while they are still loading, unloading side of VK, look at this. This is 24,000. They are a minute behind and they have 24,000. This is
it's
not
the same
good.
Issue we saw in the first match. It just you cannot get anywhere near the level of grain to even it out.
No, you can't. This is advantage Trelleborg. They stop at 2.9. I'm sure they won't. They are, you can see it here. Simon is sitting there, waiting for VK, basically saying, come on in. Oh no, he's actually going for 3.0. It's like, you know what? Let's just stop the bail.
We don't need to worry about that.
No, it's fine. And now he's just waiting there, sitting there. Making sure that VK is not scoring anymore.
Yeah.
And now
VK
they try to unload.
Trying to deliver.
Are they? Are they trying? Are they just standing there? Are they? You know.
I think he's not quite worked out where the proper drop point is.
Is it holiday season already? Because they are clearly at the beach or something.
Why are they wasting time?
And I think he just did not get the exact angle. Look at this. He's not getting the exact angle. He's like, what, why? Oh,
he's
God.
He's got to turn around and come back. He's not got it.
No, that is disaster. That is absolute disaster. Trelleborg, I mean, they are not scoring that much right now, but they are wasting BK's time a lot. This is
2 minutes 46 on the clock, and it's,
And now Trelleborg is like, oh yeah, by the way, we do still have grain, right? Let's just make sure that you guys are aware. Let's use it. 2.5 to 1.5, 1.6, okay. So it's
even to be about a 6-point difference based on the previous game.
At least, yeah. I think it's going up to 1.7 or something, but that's where it ends. And then they have to try and do something about this guy. There he is, Lucas, 70 points ahead. Yeah, exactly what we expected, 1.7 to 2.3. Yeah. And BK is trying to deliver bales, so is Trelleborg, and they are getting a massive amount of points here. 2 minutes
are
left.
They are just dominating.
Yeah, they are absolutely dominating. They are making sure that people remember that they are the favorites of the tournament. Everyone is already talking about Grimmer and about John Deere, and Trelleborg is just like, oh yeah, these are the guys who lost against that, you know, 16th placed wildcard team. And they are now, let me just remind you that we are the best team in the league. Thank you.
This is why we're the best team in the league. We can come in and we can just dominate this.
Did you know we can do this? Basically. 6.38 to 5.37. And Trelleborg is not stopping there. This will very well be an 800-point game for Trelleborg. They are making sure they prove everyone wrong when people started talking about all the other teams. And it's nice to see the boys back. right? It's nice to see that Trelleborg is back on their feet, that they are showing a strong showing here.
It's also an interesting game to see that Trelleborg here are scoring the same kind of points as Grimmer were in that in the first two matches.
Yeah.
So even if if those two end up in the final together, then that could be a real grudge match.
And that can actually happen if you think about it. I mean, Trelleborg is in a lower bracket, so if they win this one, they play against the winner of Burning Gamers versus Horsch, and only in the finals they can meet John Deere or Grimmer, because they are in the upper bracket, because John Deere finished second, same as Trelleborg, so they are not in the same bracket. But we are not there yet, right? VK is not done here. Even if this game is not winnable for them anymore. This is over. It's 1-0 Trelleborg for sure. We have 15 seconds on the clock. Trelleborg is trying to get that 800-point game, because that always looks very strong. 817, there we are. 840, there we are. That might be 860. Yeah, it will be
that
about 860.
Really
870.
From
absolutely.
Is that going to be a 900?
Dominated. No, it's over. No. 870, and these guys are looking happy. Look at this. They're like, oh yeah, that was good. That was nice.
That was such a strong game from Trelleborg.
And VK's like, oh boy.
You can see it in the guys from VK's faces.
They are wondering, why are they back in form?
Look,
who allowed Trelleborg to be back in form?
34 bales to 28 and 6,000 more.
Massive win for Trelleborg. They really want to be in the finals here, you can tell. Insane. However, I mean, as much as we talk about Trelleborg and how good they are and how strong they are, VK had a bad start. We have to keep that in mind. They still had a very strong showing. They made sure they got what they wanted. They couldn't win with it, but the tactic actually worked. So I wonder if once VK gets what they need, if they can have a bit more of a fight, let's phrase it that way. Because VK is a very, very good team.
I think if they get the second harvester, if it's a more even setup at the start, it will give VK more opportunity to disrupt what Trelleborg are doing. And as we know, that is the thing that beats Trelleborg. When you're on the back foot like that, when you get disrupted straight off the off like that, especially against a team like Trelleborg, it is very, very difficult for you to win. And we do think, as you said earlier, there may have been a team that did it. Grimmer may have beat them with only one harvester. But it's a very difficult thing to do.
It absolutely is.
And I think you need a certain element of luck to pull that off.
Oh, and I just got word from our tech team behind us that actually VK was on purpose not delivering the grain when they stand there. And that is an interesting thing to do. What they planned to do is they wanted to pretend they are unloading so that Trelleborg sees that the bonus is, going back for them. And Trelleborg starts to unload their grain into nothing because they didn't need to. The belt was stopped. And that way, Trelleborg would lose a couple of thousand liters and the bonus would maybe go up higher than 1.7, but Trelleborg did not fall for it. Simon was just waiting, was just not pushing back until he saw that bonus going up for VK. So it didn't work out, but it seems to, at least that's what we are guessing here, right? We haven't spoken to the guys. They are still on the field.
That is an interesting tactic.
It's an interesting take, and it could be because VK is clever.
Yeah. And it is an attempt to disrupt, which is interesting, but it's one that's very.
Absolutely. As long as this bonus is not going back to 2.9, I'm not starting to unload.
Yeah.
There is no point. Okay, game two, VK versus Trelleborg. VK has to win two in a row to make it to the semifinals. Trelleborg one win away from advancing to the semifinals and playing that second game tomorrow. Again, we start at noon German time tomorrow, 11 BST, and wherever that is in your time zone, it's basically same time as today. Oh, the Deutz is banned. Trelleborg is like, yeah, you know what? You guys are picking first. You guys are picking first. You're not getting one of the big ones.
That's almost like banning Euro. I guess it's trying to make VK bans stuff and leaves stuff open doing that. Must be.
Yeah, probably is. Let's see what they go for. I guess they go for the New Holland. Of course they do go for the New Holland. As we said, you want that tractor for Lucas. He is very comfortable on it. And that's totally what you need. You need your Star Stacker to be on his favorite tool, basically. The Messi, not banned this time, so it is on. Is picked by Trelleborg. Interestingly enough, VK seems to have known that Trelleborg has practiced with it or something. Because, you know, why ban it? Because Trelleborg picks it.
Nobody going for the Telehandler.
No, I don't expect anyone to use the Telehandler. Telehandler is very, very hard to handle. And there are only so many teams who made a good impression with the Telehandler. John Deere being the most famous one, they use it a lot. And Flexo Fabio is really good with it. But most teams don't really use that one. I mean, it's very fast and it is very versatile. It has a lot of good things, but you can't pick up Bale Presses. And we shouldn't forget here, Trelleborg would never pick that. I'd say 80% of their rushes are Bale Press rushes. They are not winning by rushing harvesters. They are usually winning by rushing for the presses. And
people,
if you have
in their rush to get to harvesters, people tend to forget
the bale presses.
The balers.
Yeah, and if you forget them against Trelleborg, they just take them all.
Yeah.
We've seen it so many times. You can't have the telehandler because you can't do it. You would limit yourself, basically. You know? It's a strategic decision to take or not take that one. So let's see. The ideal is right in the middle. Trelleborg is slower this time. VK will grab the case. Trelleborg, however, has the John Deere and the ideal again. And there
VK
is the
going.
VK has the New Holland. All good. They have two. And now Trelleborg is trying to grab as many balers as possible. The Kuhn press seems to be fine. Yep, that is a Trelleborg one. Lucas is grabbing the New Holland.
That
nice.
Must be a baler streak.
Yeah,
that
it is a Baylor
streak.
And if you are VK, you better start asking. Do we have one? Do we have anything?
They did manage to grab the Krone early on. So.
Was it the Krone or was it the Fendt they got? Are you sure it's the Krone?
It's the Krone. Yeah,
it is the Krone. It is the Krone. You are right. So there is that. They have a Baylor, two harvesters, still advantage Trelleborg because they got three Baylors. However, VK was able to get the Krone press, which is very good. It is the if you only end up with only one, you either want the Krone or the Fendt, right? Ideally, you want the Krone because it can have three bales. And it is the only press that can have three bales at a time. And that is very needed, especially because the Anderson is not meter anymore. It has fallen out of the meter like five tournaments ago. So people are just delivering bales one by one. And then you want to have the Krone so you can deliver five of them at a time.
Here's Ravlix going along with the Fendt baler, which is, of course, the quickest baler in the game. It takes less straw to create a bale with that one.
Yeah,
it's actually the most efficient baler as well.
Absolutely, and it's the Trelleborg favorite, right? If they want to have only one, they will always go for the Fendt.
It's actually a pretty good baler to have if you only have one harvester as well, because to be able to create more bales out of less straw is something you really, really need when you're down to a single harvester.
Yeah, and you can do that with the Kuhn as well. Ever since the Kuhn has been buffed, it is a really good press as well. It needs less straw as well. But still, people are usually aiming for that beast. The Krone press is what you want if you have a choice, unless you're Trelleborg, that is because they really want Fendt. Good. 12 minutes 20 to go. We are still in preparation phase. Both teams have two harvesters on the field, which should even out everything that is happening later on a bit. And no first bale taken so far. Felix, aka Rablix, is the team captain, is delivering the first bales, I guess. And he will most likely just put one on the belt and get that first bale points in. Because, 40 points are 40 points. There's no reason not to take them if you can. Have a quick look at the minimap. Team Blue is not delivering right now. They are way behind. So, first bale is definitely going over to Trelleborg. And if I would be VK, I would not put that one on the belt now. I would be aware.
That would That one's to be sitting down beside ready. And yeah, first bell gone to Trelleborg. 40 points on the board. Off he goes again.
They try to get as many bells as possible. I mean, this time, because it's way more even, if you're a Trelleborg, you need to be prepared for the bail boost again. But if you're a VK, you don't mind the grain boost anymore. So it's interesting to see what the teams are going for. I'm not sure what the strategy is just yet.
I would actually say being a bailer down to a single bailer, VK wants the grain boost, not the bail boost. Because if they can give themselves an advantage with how much each of their bales scores, then they have to deliver fewer bales, which is then not a problem.
You got the point, good sir. That is absolutely true. But Trelleborg, they usually play with grain boost as well, so it might be that Trelleborg is absolutely fine with that. But then again, you have seen how many bales they can deliver, right?
Exactly.
In order to have more bales delivered than Trelleborg, you need, I don't know, a fourth player or something. I'm not sure how to do it.
Well, that's the thing. They need to get that extra wheat, which means... But the thing is, when you're down to a single baler, you can actually harvest for longer.
Yes.
So as a result, that does give VK a little bit of advantage going into the grain boost.
It depends, right? I mean, Trelleborg has to match it.
If VK decides
to stay on the field with two harvesters for longer, and they should, because they only have one whale press, Trelleborg just needs to do it as well. They need to just wait with the second baler and make sure their two harvesters are out there as well. They have the better ones. They have the John Deere and the Ideal, which are the best right now. So, I mean, depending on what team you ask, the John Deere might not be the second best, but it is beloved by a lot of people.
But I think what I think is that it all depends on how closely Trelleborg are watching their opponents, because if they are, and this is Trelleborg, so I fully expect them to be, but if they aren't watching and they don't notice that the other team is staying out longer with the harvesters, then that is where the advantage for VK can be and where they can actually take this.
True. But you usually, I mean, I don't expect all the teams to have a look at the minimap at all times and see where the other ones are at. But what you usually do is you have a look at the left side of your screen where you see Team Blue and you see two harvesters still manned by Ventil and Reno. And then you know they are still on the field with it. However, Trelleborg is now just now switching to a one harvester strategy. Simon is
That's not good. Both bales dropped near that bridge. He's going to have to waste some valuable seconds going back and grabbing those, or the next person comes through and grabs them on the way.
Yeah, that was a mistake by Felix. However, it shouldn't be too bad right now because it's still early in the game. But it is a couple of seconds lost. Advantage VK, definitely advantage VK in this regard. And they are still out with two harvesters. They do exactly what you said they would do. They stay on two harvesters, make sure that they get as much as possible. And Trelleborg only has one harvester on the field right now. The John Deere is just sitting there empty, waiting for Simon to return with the Ideal. And now VK is switching as well. What are they doing now? Why is everyone running? One of you guys needs to, you know, stay with...
They're heading over to pick up tractors, but they do need somebody back out on one of those combines as soon as it empties.
Yeah, but I think what they do is they're going to attach the narrow tires now to the auger wagon. Yeah. That's exactly what Reno is doing. And it was very well timed. Both combines are still unloading, so no second left lost here. Very well done. And let's see if Felix does something with the two bales. I expect him to just... Oh, nice! He just pushes them a bit.
Forward a little bit.
You know, if he's going over that bridge two more times, the bales are in position.
Yeah.
That's
we are now topic. About halfway through the window for the power-up drops.
And how many bales does they have? Did you see how many bales are there? Yeah. Two, four... I don't know. That was too quick. A lot. But there's also a lot for Team VK. And yeah, that is the man of the game right now, the drone. Everyone is waiting for the drone to do their magic.
45 seconds left of this window.
Come on, do your magic. Push it out. Do it. Do it.
Where is it?
It doesn't want to. And VK is not even caring. There's no one
VK
close to
the nowhere near it.
No, no, they don't care. They're like, yeah, let's just do what we do best. And Lucas is did he just grab the two bales that Felix dropped?
I think
or
he
what
might have
doing?
Just grabbed the two bales.
Now, everything is in position. This is a very late drone drop. 15 seconds left. That drone is not willing to cooperate today.
10 seconds left.
Oh, there it
we
is.
Go. And they've dropped.
Is anyone grabbing a bale boost grabbed by team... grain boost, sorry. Grabbed by Team Trelleborg.
Interesting.
So. Absolutely. But that means that Trelleborg is super confident in their own tactic. They're like, yeah. We know, it could be better for you guys if we take that, but you know what? We are a better team, so we still
VK
do it anyway.
Needs to go and drop their grain first.
Yeah, but they won't. Because look at the minimap. VK is nowhere near dropping anything right now. They are not driving anywhere, and neither is Trelleborg.
Oh, they have switched over to their...
Yeah, now they start. Now they start.
So has Trelleborg, and both teams are heading to drop their grain.
34,000 full auger wagon here for Team Trelleborg. 34,000, 31,000
for... Okay,
that is not good. And that's not what you wanted.
That was exactly what
you've spoken about before. You want to have two harvesters out there for longer so that you can have more grain, but you don't. And Trelleborg is already starting. This is very clever. The bales are on there. Trelleborg has this tiny advantage. So they get 22 points right now, maybe 24, depending on, when the bales are going in, because it's skipping between 2.4 and 2.3.
And it's good to see Trelleborg using this tactic. It's something that I've pulled my hair out saying teams should be doing for most of the season.
Yeah,
why
absolutely.
Are you not loading bales on there the moment your multiplier is going up? Because the worst that's going to happen is your belt slows down and you score more points with it. And here we can see exactly why you want to do that. Because you're going to... They scored points at 1.7. At 2.3.
Exactly. And now they only have 2.1 left.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and that's something... I remember we have spoken about it a lot during the season. Teams are trying to get the bales on the belt when they have the highest bonus possible. But they don't realize, or they did not realize very fast, that the highest bonus possible might actually be while unloading. Because
the
other team will just...
It surprised me that Trelleborg is the one team that I'm now...
That figured it out,
exactly. Figured it out.
I mean, I've seen more teams trying to do that, but it took them a while. It took a couple of tournaments, and we shouldn't forget, this is a very young esport. This game is still quite new, so... There is still some learning involved in the game, right? And we just now see, like, the tactic with the bale press, to just attach it and then jump out of the tractor and abandon it. We haven't seen that before. And this is the very last tournament of the season. There is nothing else coming. There's one more day tomorrow, and then we are done with the season. And just now, they are starting to do that, right? And because of that... Because of everything Trelleborg does right now and everything Trelleborg does right now, they have a very healthy lead. 3 minutes left, 228 to 451. And Rablix is just like, let me jump. I'm Rablix.
I can jump that. Doesn't matter.
I'm a rabbit.
We've got enough points.
I'm a rabbit because his name is Hasenberger, which means Rabbit Mountain. And that's why it's his nickname. Ventil coming over with bales. VK is very, very aware that they need to deliver more bales than Trelleborg now. And this is super hard to do.
30 point difference. Ooh, losing control.
But everything is fine.
But
it worked out. All planned.
It did.
I just don't see VK scoring enough points right now.
I know. That is such a goal for 2 minutes left. I don't see how.
Oh, that was nicely done. Using a bridge for two vehicles. Very well done. And Lucas has a lot of bales.
That's how you do it without getting stuck behind.
Exactly. you can't leave a 5-second gap in between the two. So yeah, 1:50 left. Trelleborg has a lot of bales to deliver. VK does have a lot of bales to deliver. However, I'd say there is a very, 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 very tiny chance that VK can turn it around. 200 points difference.
Something would have to go wrong, such as this.
Super wrong. Like,
Ravlik's going into the dike with that.
Yeah, or Lucas just has to leave because of for some reasons and just stands up and leaves the stage. That is the only way how VK can come back now.
I was about to say, one of them disconnects, but the thing is, they can't disconnect where they are. So.
No, we are on the tournament client right here in the giant studio, so that would be hard to do. But that doesn't work. There's no disconnection for Trelleborg. And that's it. Trelleborg is back. They are back in
form. This is going to be another high-scoring round for Trelleborg. And VK can't make that kind of mistake.
No, you can't. But they probably know. I mean, there's so many points behind, and there are only 45 seconds left. There is not much you can do anymore.
Over 300 points difference.
Yeah. At this point, I think what you have to do is have a nice last 30 seconds of the season. Enjoy your time there and then congratulate Trelleborg, because this game is absolute. Trelleborg is scoring more than 700 points, that's for sure.
And you can kind of see it on their faces.
Yeah, they know. 20 seconds left, and Bentil is at least getting some extra points.
For continuing to fight, but they know at this point there is.
And that's what I mean. Just make sure you get a nice screenshot for your friends. Yeah. Stay there, and congratulations Trelleborg for advancing to the semi-finals and winning that one. 755 to, what was it? Oh, we were going to get the score in a second, I guess. There we are, the boys are back. Trelleborg back in form. Well fought, VK, and we have to say that again. You are the newest team on that stage, and you have done very well, very well. 755 to 486.
And look at that, they're nearly 10 more bales delivered, 3,000 more litres of wheat. It were, again, Trelleborg just playing as the Trelleborg of old.
Yeah. And this is also just telling all the other teams out there, by the way, guys, we are still here, right? Because, I mean, the other teams have to think the same thing we did when Trelleborg was just failing so hard during group stage. I mean, they were one game away from being eliminated. And they somehow managed to come back. They somehow managed to get into that final eight. And people started talking about Trelleborg. You know, they lost their grip. They are not the same anymore. And this is basically Trelleborg saying, by the way, guys, we are still here. And we are still rocking.
Yeah, they did come. I mean, in that group stage, they did come back. And it wasn't that they only just beat the team of Elite Guys to get back into these finals. It's that they trounced the team of Elite Guys to get back into these finals. There was no worry at any point in that final game in the group stages that they played that they weren't going to win.
Yeah, absolutely. However, it took them four games to win the first time against Team of Elite Guys. Team of Elite Guys won 2-0, and then in the loser bracket, they were 1-0 ahead again.
Yeah.
And now Trelleborg is back, and it's nice to see these guys rocking again. I wonder how they do tomorrow. They will play against the winner of Burning Gamers vs. Horse, and I'm going to translate this very quick for you guys.
Naja, nachdem ihr jetzt eigentlich, es mittlerweile jeder weiß, dass ihr Maschinen und keine Menschen seid, würde mich jetzt mal interessieren, auf welchem Betriebssystem lauft ihr denn eigentlich?
Ja. Martin asked, everyone knows that you are machines and not humans, so what's your operating system?
Glücksabhängig, würde ich sagen. Und ja, natürlich, es können auch dabei, aber auch oft Glück.
Ja, dann habt ihr aber sehr viel Glück eigentlich, ne?
Oh, Felix. Being just Felix is like, well, we were lucky. Of course, we know how to play the game, but we are just lucky.
Habt ihr euch jetzt da nochmal zusammengerauft in der Zwischenzeit? Oder also das Spiel jetzt sah jetzt eigentlich recht solide aus, sage ich mal ein paar.
Yeah, Martin asking for about the group stage, that it was very tough for them to even make it to the final eight, and if they practiced more or did something.
Deutlich mehr trainiert. Bei der Gruppenphase war es vielleicht ein bisschen zu wenig.
Felix is like, yeah, we practiced more. We slacked a bit for group stage, and that wasn't very clever. So we practiced more. We practiced a lot.
Ja. Und der 6M.
Ja, also lack of practice is what they said.
Erstaunt fast am Anfang, aber steckt da eigentlich noch ein bisschen Taktik dahinter oder einfach mal ausprobiert und losgelegt?
Nee, das war eigentlich ein Fehler meinerseits. Und ja, ich hätte vielleicht den JSP nicht bannen dürfen, aber ja.
Oh, now they're asking if. Okay.
Also.
Oh, ja, if there was a new tactic, aussieht, dann, and Felix was like, no, I just accidentally banned the wrong thing.
Und,
so, seems they are still nervous.
Dann,
but, yeah, so Martin said that he was very lucky, but I don't feel it was, to be honest.
Gegner hätte ich natürlich Burning Gamers gerne. Und ich denke, wenn die ihre Taktik so durchziehen, dann sollte es eigentlich passen.
Ja.
Martin asked what they want to play, and Felix is like, I would love to play against the Burning Gamers, and I think they will win.
Dann danke ich dir. Ihr könnt jetzt nochmal erholen und vielleicht.
We're gonna have a short break, guys, and we are back in a few minutes with Burning Gamers versus Horsch.
An die Pause.
Yeah. I'm ready to play now. Put me in the game now. Came here to prove it, I'm ready to do it, I can't be afraid now. Put me on the stage now, I'm ready to rage now. I feel like an animal stuck in a cage and I'm ready to break out. So what are you afraid of? Those feelings are made of. Get in the game, your moment of fame, show them what you made of. It's time that we stand up, it's time that we man up. For anyone asking who is the best, we putting our hands up. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. This time, like the last time, you better get ready to race to the top. I'm ready to do this, show you what the truth is. I step on the field, it's time to get real. I'm feeling so ruthless. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. Lower the lights down. Hand over my crown. Hand over my heart. I do this for my town. I do this for my crowd. So turn me up real loud. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop.
Back for the final match of day one of the finals of the World Championship. It has been insane so far.
It's been an amazing tournament so far.
Absolutely has been. It was a lot of fun so far.
I didn't expect that last match to quite go as way the way it did.
No.
I thought VK were going to be a little bit. This sounds a little bit harsh, but I thought VK were going to be a little more of a challenge for Trelleborg.
Absolutely, absolutely. So how do you feel about new old Trelleborg now? Are they back to be tournament favorites? What do you think?
I think if they play like that through the rest of these finals, yeah, I fully expect Trelleborg to win.
Yeah, or at least make finals.
Yes. The interesting thing is the way they're playing is very similar to the way that Grimmer are playing, and if those two face each other in the finals, I think we're very much looking at a very, very close final.
Yeah, so we're going to see some replays. And here is that exact situation where we're like, what is he doing? What is he doing? And it could actually be, look at this. It could actually be that he is like, yeah, let's just pretend. But I'm not sure because I would say that is his tactic. But then he's doing that turn now. And that shows me that he wasn't happy with the position he was in.
He was a long way over. It looked more like a mistake than a tactic.
Yeah. It could still be. It could still be, but I think it was a mistake. That was a mistake as well. This bail right there is not going anywhere.
Nope. And VK did make a lot of mistakes like that going through.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that really is the trouble with it, is that they weren't doing all that well at fending Trelleborg off. Trelleborg were disrupting them constantly, and that was what was really hurting them more than anything.
Absolutely. And this is another thing where you can just see how good Trelleborg is. Look at everything is just prepared, everything is nice. And yeah. Lucas is just doing Lucas magic here. No.
Trades and
it's just beautiful watching this guy playing. It's just beautiful
and taking full advantage of that bonus. You know, every single bale that went onto that conveyor, they got a 1.6 1.7 2.4 bonus on.
You know what, should I tell you a secret here that is a sad one though? Is that the time for a sad secret? this is Lucas' final tournament. This guy is retiring after Worlds.
Oh, wow.
Because he started his new job, and he wants to focus on his new job. So the best player in the league, Lucas, is retiring. This is his victory lap, basically. And Trelleborg is trying to make this very nice for him. Wow.
He was absolutely dominating in the stacking there.
Yeah, absolutely was. He's just so good.
He is so good at it.
But let's look at again. Because we're going to see now the two, I'd say, surprise teams. And Martin will introduce them in a few seconds. And they are the Burning Gamers by Stark and Horsch. Let's have the show for Martin.
Ja, ich bin auch gespannt, ob wir jetzt mal ein Spiel sehen oder eine Partie sehen, die über drei Spiele geht, anstatt über zwei. Aber ja, diejenigen, die es schaffen können, das sind unsere nächsten beiden Teams. Und dann begrüße ich unser erstes Team. Das blaue Team diesmal, die Burning Gamers, Richie, Lamy und...
And here we are, Burning Gamers by Stark, the last remaining wildcard team. That means they don't really have they do have a sponsor with Stark, but they organized everything themselves. And on the other side, the oldest team in the league, Team Horsch. And we all know these guys very well. They have been here from day one. They were the very first team to ever be created. They played back in the Farming Simulator Championship. They were the first team to sign up for the Farming Simulator League. A very, very traditional team. And here are the stats. Burning Gamers finished 7th. Horsch finished 9th. Horsch does have more average bales. The Burning Gamers, being the first team to ever utilize the grain boost, have a higher grain delivered average. Points, however, Horsch is way ahead, and the win percentage for both teams doesn't look too good.
Head-to-head score 1-0 to Burning Gamers, so these two teams haven't faced each other very much either. So.
Yeah, and if you just look at raw data and at the all 8 teams that made it into the finals, you'd go, oh, this is the weakest match of the day. This is just two super weak teams playing each other. I don't even know why they're here, blah, blah, blah. But the truth is, this is the exact opposite, actually. Burning Gamers won their group. They won group 2. They won against John Deere. And they are here as the group head of group B. So they are super strong right now. And Horsch, they haven't played too well over the last 4 or 5 tournaments. But then during the group stage, they came back. They've beaten JCD, which is insane if you think about it, because this Czech team is so strong. So two teams that have shown that they are very good on the stage.
Absolutely amazed that they beat JZD. That's I expected them to be in the final, and Horsch fair and square beat them. You know, really good match.
That and was. I've spoken to Mr. Marcel afterwards. The team captain was like, "Well, that was a surprise," and he was like, "Well, it wasn't even a surprise for us because you know they knew that JZD is just so good that they didn't really expect to make it." I mean, they were hoping and they were practicing, and that's what he told me. He was like, "Well, we were well prepared. We believe we can do it. However, we knew that it is a very hard game to play because JZD is just so good." So yeah, interesting final match of the day. The winner will advance to the semifinals, and Trelleborg is waiting. That's something you don't really want right now. Like, both teams were probably quite happy with where they ended up in the bracket, right? With Grimma being on the other side of the bracket, John Deere being on the other side of the bracket, Krone being on the other side of the bracket. You're like, oh yeah, that's nice. We are just here with this Trelleborg guys who don't really know how to play anymore. And Trelleborg is like, well, guess what? We are back. So all of a sudden, they are probably like, oh shit, this is not good. Yeah. So what do you expect to see? I'll tell you what I expect to see first. Burning Gamers, they are very strong with the grain boost. I expect them to run a grain boost tactic. I expect them to 2-0 Horsch. That's what I'm saying right now. I expect the Burning Gamers to 2-0 Horsch here.
I think I'm actually going for a 2-1 again, but I think it might be 2-4. Gamers are a really good team, but Horsch recently have seemed to have found their feet again, and are just playing well.
So, that is true. That is absolutely true.
It's a consistency thing that makes me think it's going to go to Horsch.
I just think Burning Gamers are very strong right now. They practice the exact right tactics, you can tell. They did it against John Deere. And I expect them to just be very well prepared for this match. That's why I give it to BG. I just think BG is the better team.
Either way, I think it's going to be close.
Either way, do you see what's not banned? I give you a hint. It's yellow.
Oh, that doesn't happen very often.
No, I don't think that has happened even once in the last 5 tournaments. I wonder if the JCD gets picked first. There it is.
Yeah, you'd have to be mad not to.
You leave the JCB open. The JCB.
Why did? Having left the JCB open, why did Horsch not take it?
I wonder if they realized. I guess no one ever practiced with this thing. Like, oh yeah, it's JCB. That one is a must ban since day one. There's nothing going to happen. And then, now probably, when Biggie just picked the JCB, Horsch is probably like, wait, that was open?
Yeah.
I don't think you expect this thing to be pickable at all, because it's always banned. I mean, they got the Steyr. And the Steyr is a fantastic little tractor. It's very fast. It's very strong. It's a good thing. But you leave the JCB open. This is insane. And you know what? Banning the New Holland instead of the JCB, I don't think that's the right decision.
I have a feeling that a mistake was made.
Yeah. I mean, the question is, can BG use it? That's the other side. I mean, having the JCB, the question is, how often are teams even practicing this thing? If you have limited practice time, would you actually practice with that tractor?
But unlike the telehandler, the JCB is just a loader tractor, but faster.
Oh yeah, it's the fastest tractor in the game. It's 65 kmh.
Not practicing with it, it just really means that in this early stage, you get to get down there.
Yeah, and they use it for the exact right thing. They use it to grab the John Deere. I mean, that's exactly what you are going to do if you have that tractor. Yeah.
You grab
and
the idea.
They also have the Krone press. What they need now is a second harvester, though, and they don't have one just yet.
That could be a very basic mistake.
So there is no harvester on side of BG so far. I mean, they do have one. They got the ideal, but where is
streak?
No, I think
harvester streak.
Yeah, I think Horsch just grabbed 3 harvesters. Oh, and there's a rush.
It's a rush!
It is a rush! BG rushed it! They were like, we can't get harvesters, we just rush it down! 1-0 BG! Baylor rush! Baylor rush! And look at these guys, they're like, can you believe that happened? Did you see that? Did we get... We did. Why did we win this?
Oh my god, where we go?
I was about to talk about how Horsch is an advantage here and how good it is for Horsch and how bad it looks for BG, and then BG is like, oh wait, you know what? Let's just grab the fourth Baylor. Oh, and Mr. Marcel is not happy. Look at the team captain here. He is not happy. He's like, hey, I want that trophy. Can we just stop doing this? I really want that trophy. Wow. No one expected. Even the league officials are still standing in their pick position, right? Because we have referees standing behind the teams during the pick and ban phase to make sure everything is working, everything is nice and dandy. And they are still there. They didn't even leave the stage before the game was over.
That is just absolutely crazy.
Absolutely is. Yeah, guys, you need to do something about it. And they know. They know. They're like, you can see Vincent is just, he's shell-shocked. He's sitting there. It's the big guy on the end. It's like,
yeah.
The hell. This guy is huge, by the way.
Not happy. Not a good start.
No, to
Horsch's
what?
Final run.
Absolutely not. One of the reasons why I would love to see Horsch win that is because I want to see Vincent doing the interview. This guy is so huge that he doesn't fit in front of the interview wall. It's completely hilarious. But it might actually not happen. 1-0 BG, very well played. It was very clever. And
yeah.
I wonder if that is going to happen again. I mean, this is technically what happens if you leave stuff like the JCB open, right? Because it's so fast, and you can... you have seen what they did. They just used it, rushed down. I mean, they won by rush, but they also rushed down, grabbed the ideal. We're like, okay, we have a harvester now. We don't get any other harvester. You know what? Let's just grab all the Baners. It was super clever.
But to turn a possible loss by a harvester streak into a win by Bale Rush is just impressive.
It is very impressive, and I wonder if they try to do it again. I wouldn't be confused if they tried to do it again. Not gonna lie. It would just make sense. So let's see if there is a change in picks and bans. Let's see if the JCB is going through again. I don't expect it to go through again. I expect it to be banned.
BG going first this time, and yeah, I fully expect them to... somebody to ban the JCB.
It has to be Horsch, though. They can't risk giving that one over again. Yeah,
oh, they banned the Steyr.
Maybe they're like, well, if you don't ban it, we pick it. And BG,
right, so
BG
what is
doesn't.
It gonna be?
Yeah, there it is.
The JCB. There it is.
They are not doing that again. They're like, well, no. Let's just not lose twice in that fashion.
Does mean the telehandler is open.
Yeah, but neither of these teams is using it, so I don't expect it to be somewhere. I see Ferguson picked. On the other side, I expect the New Holland to come in, or the Valtra. There is the Valtra. I totally see that New Holland coming on the field anyway. There it is.
There it is.
Of course.
It would be an odd
round.
Probably
the Fendt on the other side. Yeah, there is the Fendt.
There we go.
And now we should see the two narrow tires, the Case and the Valtra. There is the Valtra. Yeah. And I would be super confused if that's not the case now. It is the telehandler! Welcome to Horsch just mixing things up again.
Horsch are rolling the dice.
I suppose
at this point they've got nothing to lose by rolling the dice.
Yeah, why not? Just take a risk. Take a risk. And now, you go with chiptuning slide edge. You are super fast. The Valtra is very fast. The telehandler is super fast. The Fendt is not as fast, but it's still fast enough. I think it's 53 as well, so it should be pretty much... Yeah, it is the same as the Valtra. Interesting. Let's see what happened. Here we go. I don't expect to see another rush, though. Not gonna lie, I don't think that's happening twice. Let's see what they go for. Our horse is having a bad start. A very, very bad start.
They don't need that.
No, you can't have a bad start right now. And BG is like, you know what? Let's grab some presses here. Horse has the ideal though. BG should get the John Deere. Yeah, and they do have the New Holland as well. So harvesters are 2 and 2. Yeah. BG has
what about Baylor's?
BG has the Fendt, Horsch has the Krone, and I don't know where the others are. The New Holland is still open, and so is the Kuhn.
New Holland, and oh, they're also heading for the Krone. The Kuhn, sorry.
And they will get them, because no one of Horsch is in a tractor right now. So they get three out of the four.
Is a Baylor streak.
There we go. Good start for BG. Horsch already on the field. BG, it will take a little bit longer for BG to get on the field now, but they do have three presses, so it is fine. Horsch, however,
and
does have
a
Krone.
Slightly different technique for how they do stuff with their harvesters.
Absolutely do. I mean, Horsch is the team that always comes up with new techniques. I mean, there is a reason why there is an entire tactic called the Horsch tactic. Right? They are usually coming up with very special ideas. So let's see if their new special idea will get them anywhere, because they have to show that they can fight with one Baylor. Otherwise, they will have a bit of an issue here.
They do at least have the Krone Baylor. So as much as they're at a disadvantage, they do at least have a Baylor that gets lots of bales back quickly. And there's a way of turning a single Baylor into an advantage in that you just keep your harvesters going for longer.
Yeah, you said that last time and it didn't work out. Let's see if it works out this time.
Oh, that's very true. And he's going to unload this straight onto the thing. This is beautiful. Look
this
at that.
This is absolutely beautiful. And this is first bale for Horsch for sure. Because that was very fast. I don't think BG is even in a position to score any. No, they are not. They're not even close to their barn. 40-0. Advantage Horsch. Nicely done. But yeah, that can't be everything. They need to show more. They need to do more. BG on the way now with the first bales, but there's no reason to hurry for them anymore. First bale is off the table, so they can just fill up the Fendt and then deliver four bales to the barn and wait for whatever happens next. Wow, this game is way slower than the last one, I feel.
It is. Yeah, it's
because it's not
all
over yet.
All of that. Excitement with the rush, and now of course we're in the early stages, and at this stage is always about what the teams are doing, how they're getting set up, what they're getting into, what position, and trying to predict what tactic they're using, and yeah.
So the obvious tactic right now is to deliver the bales right next to the barn, make sure that they are ready there, nicely set up for whatever boost is happening. We can see Richie has delivered the first four bales, getting back onto the field and see what else he can grab. Of course, the other players still being in the harvesters won't help him right now. Same goes for Horsch. Mr. Marcel is doing all the baling work, while Deutz Freak and Monty are in the harvesters making sure that they get a lot of grain and get a lot of straw on the ground so that they can press more bales later on.
And this line of straw that you see at the top of the field, that is always there.
There's always
a line of straw at the beginning. So nobody's taken a harvester up to the top end of the field.
No.
And just randomly baled a line of straw.
It is just there for the teams to pick up and start baling right away if you want to. And I think all the teams are using it by now. When we introduced it in the beginning, I don't think people were too eager to use it right away, but very quickly it turned out to be a very good thing to get the first bales very quick, and ever since everyone is using it. The meter has shifted a lot over the course of the season. I mean, there was a time where you couldn't play without the Anderson. No one would.
Yeah.
And now the Anderson is priority pick.
I think it was Trelleborg who started disrupting that play. And basically became unbeatable.
There were a couple of tactics against it. I remember Komatsu and the Burning Gamers trying to counter the Anderson by going grain boost. That wasn't too popular either in the beginning of the season. People would usually just go for bale boost. Komatsu and Burning Gamers turned that one around, going with the grain boost and winning every now and then. John Deere and Trelleborg, as you said, they would just go with very fast tractors and just deliver the bales with two bale presses instead of the Anderson. And yeah, the Anderson fall out of meta because of everything teams were doing against it. Basically, it wasn't so great anymore. And ever since, it never came back. We buffed it recently, but still.
There are tactics that you can use that just work well with it. I think that the Coon Baler, that would now be a great one to use with the Anderson. Same goes for the Fendt. I think either of those balers could be very strong to use with that because they can just produce bales that much faster, and then you're not having to run back all the time with the baler to drop stuff off.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the Anderson, there are a lot of reasons why you would still use it because it's still really, really good. However, playing against one of the top 8 teams in the world, if you pick the Anderson, if you use the Anderson, you are pretty much locked to your tactic, right? Everyone knows what you are going to do because you have the Anderson. So there's very little room to adapt. And if you adapt, you wasted a power up because you have an Anderson that you are not utilizing. We have seen that with Lindner in the very first game. So picking the Anderson is a risk because you know your opponent is countering your play 100% of the time because they know exactly what you're going to do. Oh, look at this. High five while driving. Check. Nice.
It's a good thing those are at different heights.
Oh, look at
this.
And
there we go. The first combine being unloaded.
And
this is BG.
They are both full to the max. It's really nice.
How have they managed that without the other team being full? Obviously, the other team...
Well, the other team is full. Look at this ideal. That looks very full to me.
Wow. That is very full. They must have already emptied. No, they haven't already emptied it.
No. 7,500 here.
Both teams pretty much neck and neck then.
Yeah, but that one doesn't look too good. I mean, they're only 7,500.
That's a long way off full. They must have already emptied that then, is what I'm thinking.
Might be. And we're gonna see that later once the team start delivering the grain to the silo. Then we will know.
Yeah, well inside the power-up window now, though.
That little fella will change the course of the game very soon. 1 minute and 20 seconds left for it to do it. It is random between minute 8 and 6, so we don't know when it's going to drop.
That's not good.
What is Mr. Marcel doing? Oh, no.
That's their only baler.
Yeah, they need to get it out. Otherwise, they have a very big issue here. And Mr. Marcel knows that. And yeah, well, that should work. But still, time lost.
And the power-ups have dropped. Green has changed just as the power-ups dropped. And it's the bale boost.
That was picked up by BG. I wonder if that was their plan. I mean, it turns out to be a solid plan right now because a horse has that many problems. But it would be quite untypical for BG. On the other hand, people know what BG is usually doing. So mixing up a bit, that's a good idea.
Nico loading bales there, and Monty doing it for Horsch.
And Monty using the telehandler, so that is very nice. This thing is not easy to handle, but if you get the grasp of it, it is really good.
Really, really maneuverable though. Yeah, you can easily turn.
I'm not sure BG is. I mean, they are not playing very clean right now. It's looking a little bit random, don't you think? Still, they are getting.
Yeah, there's a lot of space for Horsch to make this here, and it's while BG are. No, it's about neck and neck that they're scoring. So that's an interesting way that's happening.
Absolutely is. And oh, look at this. Wow, this is full.
That is a very full grain trailer. And he has...
He has still stuff left. He's like, well...
Yeah.
I think we harvested too much.
They finished harvesting one end of the field and they're harvesting the other.
And BG is already on their way. So advantage BG again. 20 seconds left on that boost. However, Deutz Freak is on his way as well, so they should both be able to, you know, utilize the bonus a bit. Again, BG doing a little bit better here. should be able to be the first. Yeah, they definitely are the first if they are starting. Would you?
They are waiting. Would you mind?
Oh no.
There we go.
There we go, and they are doing exactly what you expect them to do.
Yeah.
See.
They're taking advantage of the maximum they can get off that multiplier. So they're gonna deliver bales at 2.3, 2.4.
Yeah.
Oh, 2.3, sorry.
But not enough though. There are no bales left. So Richie is like, oh.
And here come the next lot.
Mr. Marcel is doing the same. 130 point lead for BG right now. Mr. Marcel making sure that some bales are there. Monty's coming with the tail handler. This guy can't do anything else. And that brings us back to the tail handler being what it is. He can't pick up any baler. He basically has to just stay there and stack. That's all he can do, really. That's all he can, contribute. That's the word that I was looking for. Contribute to his team right now. Oof. And that looks very good for BG.
Why are BG still harvesting
that? Yeah,
have they run out of straw?
This confuses me a lot, and we've spoken about it over and over again over the course of today's matches. Why would you keep harvesting? Isn't there something else you can do? Can't you just press bales, for example? Make sure that you get bales into that barn. I heard that is a very, very healthy way to win this game, to have just bales into the barn. And
mind you, they are so far ahead.
They are super far
ahead.
And
in fact, I can see why Horsh have increased the bonus. So that they're now delivering bales that are worth more points than BGs are. And but there still is enough time for Horsh to make this up.
Oh, absolutely. They are less than 100 points behind now. Horsh is actually closing the gap, but there are bales coming in for BG. BG's well on their way to ensure that the difference is bigger again. There we go. But yeah, Horsh is fighting. They are still fighting back, and they are doing very well right now. 2:30 left. 91 points different, and every bale that Horsh delivers just gives more points. Everything is possible. 70 points. Interesting. BG coming in with more bales. There are enough bales lying around. Maybe you guys want to put that one on the conveyor belt, you know, you're scoring some points.
That might be a wise idea, that.
And
there's still grain in the tank on the John Deere.
Yeah, and
I think they ran out of straw. I think that's what happened with BG. They ran out of straw.
That has to be the reason. That has to be the reason. I don't see why they would do what they did.
No.
That can't happen, Monty.
Horsh just
you need to be precise now. If you want to turn around this game, and you still can, there is just a 90-point difference, you really need to make sure that all the bales are on that bell. Oh, no.
Why aren't they putting that bale straight on the conveyor?
Look at the face of Monty. He is just super unhappy with what he does right now. Mr. Marcel is helping here. Oh no, it's Deutz Freak. Deutz Freak used to be one of the best stackers in the league. Do you remember that in the beginning of the season? He was up there with Lucas and Flexo Fabio. However, because of his internet connection, because he's from the countryside, he couldn't practice that much. So
I know all about dodgy internet connections in the countryside.
Yeah, I know you do, my friend. I know you do. 6:29 to 5:10, a minute left. This is an insane game, and you can see what the telehandler is technically able to do if you know how to do it.
Yeah.
Monty is trying, and that looks good. That was nice.
But however, over 100 point difference again now.
Yeah, it looks very, very good, very, very solid for BG. And as long as BG is getting bales onto that belt, and look at this, there are more than enough. This should be enough to make it to semifinals tomorrow. 705 points.
Now,
why would you
switch balers like that? That's an interesting choice. Switching balers from the Coombe to the New Holland does not make a lot of sense.
No, I don't know why they do it. But
I think Horsh aren't trying anymore.
They know it's over.
They know it's all over.
Congratulations to BG being the fourth team to make it into the semifinals. They will face Trelleborg tomorrow. And Horsh, they know. They're sitting there like, yeah, we know. It's over. Almost 800 points. No, 791. Almost 800 points. Impressive. Congratulations, Burning Gamers by Stark. You are in the semifinals. You will return on that stage tomorrow in game 2 against Trelleborg. So this is the semifinal set. It's Grimmer versus John Deere and Trelleborg versus Burning Gamers by Stark. Very, very interesting.
That is quite a lineup for tomorrow. Those the stronger teams have gone through definitely today. It's been close in a couple of places.
Absolutely. Corona versus John Deere comes to mind here.
Yeah, Corona versus John Deere. That was our closest game of the day, where it was 2-0 and it really, really didn't tell the story.
No, it doesn't. If you are tuning in just now and you check the standings, you're like, oh, that wasn't close, but it was.
Yeah.
We're gonna have a final interview, and there won't be any break after the interview anymore because we are done with the games for today. So that means we're gonna have the final interview in a couple of seconds, and then afterwards we will be back to have some replays and basically close off today. But for now, we need to head over to Martin. I just get word that the interview is still setting up. We'll take another 10, 15 seconds or something. Yeah. There we go. Interview is about to happen. I'm going to translate that one. You know how that works.
Ja, genau. Ich stehe jetzt hier mit Nico, dem Captain des Siegerteams. Hi. Wir haben jetzt ja schon mal das im Auge behalten, haben dann gemerkt, jetzt dadurch, dass ihr gewonnen habt, sind eigentlich Gruppe A und B aus der Gruppenphase weiter. Das heißt, C und D ist komplett raus. Ihr kennt eure Gegner.
Mm-hmm. Martin just mentioned that every winning team was from Group A or B, so they know them all.
Hochkarätige Gegner jetzt noch im Halbfinale, und wie siehst du so
alle? What do you think about the situation right now?
Sehr starke Gegner, die wir jetzt noch haben. Wird auch sehr, sehr schwer für uns. Das ist gar keine Frage. Muss schauen. Wir sind eigentlich stolz im Moment, so weit, wie wir bisher gekommen sind. Wir sind Top 4 der Welt. Kann man so stehen lassen, eigentlich auch schon.
And he's like, well, we are top 4 in the world, everyone is super strong right now, but we are very proud of where we are right now.
Aber jetzt natürlich kommen wir zu der Frage, die wahrscheinlich dann alle auch ein bisschen auf der Zunge brennt. Das erste Spiel, das war ja recht kurz, aber das war auch nicht ganz so geplant. Auf der anderen Seite, ihr habt den JCB bekommen.
Right,
wie hast du das ganze Spiel so erlebt? Ich meine, den JCB sieht man nicht so oft, das war nicht geplant.
Martin is asking, how did you see that game? You got to JCB, it was confusing.
Wir wussten, dass sie eigentlich die gleiche Taktik fahren. Das ist eigentlich auch daran gelegen, dass wir 4 Stacker haben, die zumindest 50 fahren können. Deswegen halt nicht so wie Trelleborg vorher, die hatten ja den John Deere, dass wir halt dann sagen, wir wollen schnellen haben. Und deswegen haben wir den nicht rausgebannt. Sie hätten den noch rausbauen können, dann wäre es halt so, aber das haben sie nicht getan. Somit hatten wir.
They decided not to pick anything that's fast because they only wanted fast stackers.
Gelegt, den Steier zu haben, haben wir uns gedacht, gut, dann nehmen wir den. Damit war jetzt noch nicht klar, dass wir das rushen, aber wir haben zumindest dann halt probiert, oder wir hatten auch vorher schon so grob gesagt, dass wenn die wirklich auf 3 Drecher fahren, wir die Pressen nehmen, weil. Yeah.
When they realized that they have the fast tractors, they were like, okay, if they want to go for harvesters, we take the presses.
Und dann hat's noch funktioniert, und dann war sehr schön im Moment auf jeden Fall.
And then they realized that they were actually driving down to get the harvesters and decided to grab all 4 presses and just rush it.
Ihr fahrt da los und schnappt euch also die ersten Geräte, und dann fällt einem auf, oh, jetzt haben wir eine Chance zu rushen, oder wie war das jetzt bei euch in dem Moment?
Ja, also wir haben ja, man hat ja seine Aufteilung.
Martin is asking, so how does it exactly work? You're just driving and then at one point you're like, hey, wait, we can rush, or how does it work?
Und dann war halt schon, eigentlich war da noch nicht klar, dann hatte ich meinen Drecher bekommen, ich glaube, Lami hatte seinen nicht bekommen, ist ja auch nicht schlimm gewesen, aber dann haben wir halt, dadurch war es dann, dass wir gesagt haben, jetzt holen wir alle Pressen, und dann meinte Lami,
and it's like, well, it's a lot of communication, we are talking, we got a harvester, we didn't get another one, and we were communicating all the time, we're like, oh, we can pick them all, let's try to rush, let's try to pick them all.
Wie kann man lockerer angehen, und ich glaube, der Druck, man hat es schon ein bisschen angesehen, der lag dann deutlich auf Horsch, also, aber habt ihr gut nach Hause gebracht, und jetzt könnt ihr erstmal euch ausruhen. Und dann morgen Halbfinale. Also
after the first game is won, you can't play with less pressure, and there's a lot of pressure on Horsch. Thank you for everything. And we are going back to basically us.
Einiges, was man noch mal
what a replays. There we go. We are back. And the German has our back as well.
That was interesting. So good communication.
Absolutely good communication. The left guy has to be super happy now because that's Werner from the Burning Gamers. His team just won.
Yes. Yep. Absolutely. So that's wow. It's been a good set of games today. It's sort of been everything. We've had a rush. We've had games that have won, you know, in the final seconds. We've had games that have been won 2 minutes out from the end.
Yeah, we have seen everything. Let's have a look at this rush game here. New Holland is still open. You can see that Deutsch Freak is trying to get it, and then it turns yellow. And it's like, nope, you can't get that one anymore. Sorry, and it's red now. Boom, over. So that was like
close rush then.
There was like a second that BG was faster. And if that wouldn't have happened, if you think about it, Horsch would have had three harvesters and everything would be different.
Nice bit of unloading here from Mr. Master.
Yeah, very nice way to get the first bale. That shows that he knows exactly how to drive the Krona. Maybe we get the replay later on where we see that he doesn't know how to drive the Krona. And just that's it.
How he ended up on top of that bale.
I don't know. I would love to see that one again because that was super weird.
Here's the aerial telehandler.
Yeah, just the flying telehandler. Do not do that at home, kids.
Does well to keep those bales on the front of that.
Yeah, I don't know how he did that. This is super confusing. But it was very nicely done.
Trying to avoid... Ooh, that actually...
Yeah, that's an interesting way to do it.
That is an interesting way to do it.
You just shouldn't. No, you shouldn't.
That could have ended up very nasty.
Still faster than driving all the way around, I guess.
It is. Very true.
So there is that. And we can see here that these tiny little things, and they happen so quickly with the telehandler. And then you lose that bale, it's another
lost that bale that's on the conveyor, and this bale then takes longer to load here as well.
Absolutely, and then the other one even falls down. You can see it in the background, it falls down, so there is no point scored with the first bale that you put up there. And this, and of course, is a disaster.
Because one isn't on well enough to get in either.
No.
So
yeah, using the telehandler, that's what I meant. Picking that one is a risk because it's so hard to use. Well, it seems that's it for today. What do you think?
That is very, very good. Very, very good set of games. It's four very strong teams going into the semi-finals tomorrow. Literally anything can happen because we've got John Deere versus Grimmer up first tomorrow, and then we've got BG versus Trelleborg.
Yeah, that will be awesome. So, guys, if you want to watch that action, because we only have a couple of seconds left before we close out the stream for today, you have to be back tomorrow at at noon German time, 11 a.m. British time, whenever that is in your time zone, make sure you tune in because we're going to have the semifinals and then the finals, and we crown the first ever world champion. Thank you for being here, Alex. And
thank you very much. I've had a ball.
And see you all tomorrow. Bye.
See you tomorrow. Bye.
Verabschieden. Es war ein spannender Tag. Aus den 8 Teams sind jetzt noch 4 übrig und es kann halt leider nur einer gewinnen. Trotzdem großer Respekt auch an die ausgeschiedenen Teams. Es war wirklich sehr unterhaltsam. Und ich bin gespannt, wer morgen dann eben die Trophäe mit nach Hause nehmen wird. Wer das sein wird, da schlafen wir jetzt noch mal eine Nacht drüber. Und dann sehen wir uns morgen um 12 Uhr wieder. Und ich sage danke, tschüss und noch einen schönen Abend.
That was. Yeah. I'm ready to play now. Put me in the game now. I came here to prove it. I'm ready to do it. I can't be afraid now. Put me on the stage now. I'm ready to rage now. I feel like an animal stuck in a cage and I'm ready to break out. So what are you afraid of? Those feelings are made of. Get in the game, your moment of fame. Show them what you made of. It's time that we stand up. It's time that we man up. For anyone asking who is the best, we putting our hands up. My time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. This time, like the last time, you better get ready to race to the top. I'm ready to do this. Show you what the truth is. I step on the field, it's time to get
time, my time. None of you people can tell me to stop. Lower the lights down. Hand over my crown. Hand over my heart. I do this for my town. I do this for my crowd. So turn me up real loud. My time.